morning, ladies and gentlemen around the world, for tuning in. Thank you. These fastest of the Olympic boats. We're 10 seconds to go to the start here. Great action here. Some of the world's best sailors on board. Top performing boat. Look at that France 81, the big foil. Whoa, the boat flying out of the water.
Welcome from the Weymouth and Portland National Sailing Academy. We are here for day two of the Gold Fleet Racing of the 2019 Volvo European Championships. Yesterday, we covered the 49er men and women's fleets for you guys. Today, it's on to the NACRAs. I've got with me Stevie Morrison, Andy Rice. I'm Jenny Tulloch. And of course, this morning, Stevie, we caught up in the boat park with John Gimson, who is winning the NACRA fleet. What did he have to say?
He's very excited. He was actually sanding down his foils, which, these boats are up out of the water. So kind of they're the fastest boats in Olympic sailing at the moment, and they're super spectacular. But of course, if you've only got a minute area of foil in the water, then the finish on that is everything. So John was, 10 minutes before putting his wetsuit on, was sanding the foils and making them perfect. But he was obviously really, really excited after yesterday. He had a very, very good day yesterday. And in fact, he's had a great regatta. He's really put it together. The Italian team, which has been so strong, he finally felt he had a bit of a handle on. So really happy. But what's great about today is we've actually got a northerly wind, or it's just east of north. It's about 0115 degrees. So it's cold, hence the jumpers. And it's a bit more English. There's a bit of cloud around. But what it's going to be is a completely different race course. They're inside Portland Harbour. It's flat water and the wind's coming off the famous Weymouth Cliffs, so it's really quite, you can see on the screen there now, the wind's coming down from the top of the cliffs there, and it's going to be very shifty, flat water, fast and furious.
Well, we've had some awesome racing so far in the NACRA fleet. Andy, you covered them a bit yesterday. Close, tight points at the top here.
Absolutely. John Gimson and Anna Burnett, who Stevie was just talking about, they're on 26 points, just 1 point in front of the Danes, Lynn Sandholt and CP Lubeck. And the previous series leaders are now in third. That's Italy's Ruggero Tita and Caterina Banti, who so dominated last year and were looking like they were going to run away with it this week, but maybe not. So those three are really close at the top. And then in fourth place is another top Italian team, Vitaro Bissara and Maieli Frascari. But they are 12 points back from their compatriots in third place. So those are the top few, but there's still plenty of others further down in contention.
Well, we know even just looking at the scores there, Gemma Jones and Jason Saunders are one of the boats that we have onboard cameras on today. So hopefully we will get to see some incredible action for them. And in terms of what we were expecting, you were talking about the breeze earlier, the forecast, Stevie. We had heard it was going to be lighter today. It's going to be lighter through the weekend. What we're seeing reality-wise, it's not quite that light out there. And you just got a little bit of tidbit from the race committee, the PRO, just before we walked into the room. What did they have to say?
Yeah, he said they're going to be inside Portland Harbour, as we explained, so flat water. They've got about 14, 15 knots of wind at the moment. The reason we're on a little bit early today and we've got all the Gold Fleets out on the water is the fact that the wind is forecast to drop. And what's pretty classic for Weymouth Bay and Portland Harbour is this northerly wind will deteriorate and fade away slowly during the day. So the best breeze is now, which is why the guys are out there, which is good news for us for the viewing. It's about 14 knots currently. There's about 20, 30 degrees a shift. And the course length for the NACRA inside Portland Harbour is about 0.8 of a mile. So they're going to be doing three laps. So there's going to be a lot of boat handling, a lot of close interaction in and out of the marks. And I think it could be pretty frenetic with a bit of action for us, hopefully.
Hopefully a bit of action. I mean, in general, I think we've actually heard about a bit of action in this fleet altogether this week, Andy. We've had two reports of capsizes on the NACRA fleet yesterday while we were covering the 49ers. Some other carnage on Tuesday on the windy day. What's going on out there?
Well, it's NACRA sailing. I mean, they're still getting to grips with these boats, and every day is a learning day. And even the best in the world, people like Nathan Outridge, winner of an Olympic gold medal in one of the hardest boats to sail, a 49er, is still having to learn the ropes on this boat. And he was one of the capsizers yesterday in between races, let alone under the pressure of actually racing. Ben Saxton leading a race yesterday, going through a jibe, and Ben, by his own admission, jumped overboard through the jibe. I mean, apparently it's so easy to do, because as you're dropping a foil down, it can suddenly push the boat up into the air and you can lose your footing really, really easily. And
I think here we're on board with the Americans. So this would be Sarah Newbery and David Liebenberg. They are actually sitting 27th overall, so just made the cutoff for the NACRA Gold Fleet, which is 28 boats here. It's the top half of the fleet. And we've just got the two onboard cameras today. We spoke up earlier about Gemma Jones and Jason Saunders, but you can see they're not quite lining up for the start yet here. I believe that's the Argentinian team behind them in fifth. Oh, apologies. Here's the U.S. team. So we were actually just on board with the Kiwis. And maybe it's not quite as windy as what we were seeing when they were starting to head out onto the harbor earlier. It looks a little bit like perhaps the breeze has died down, although with a catamaran, when you drop both hulls in the water, it can look pretty light regardless. And as we said, it's quite flat water in the harbor.
Yeah, I think, I don't know, from having done a lot of sailing with a video camera looking at you, it always looks a lot less windy for a camera than it does when you're actually out there involved. So we could stand up and look out the window, mm-hmm. which is possibly what we should do, but we can see they're in the last sort of 3-4 minutes. I think there's still a decent breeze. I mean, it's not crazy windy, but speaking to John Gimpson, basically, we should be looking really at potentially some upwind foiling. There's going to be a lot more shifts, and again, Andy mentioned Nathan Outridge, and he's possibly had one of his most disappointing regattas in the NACRA so far. But what he said is they've been out on the race course out at sea. It's been a really, really serious sea state. Now, I've been lucky enough to do a little bit of sailing in foiling boats, and one thing I do know is that foiling boats in waves is not an awful lot of fun. Because your reference point for the mechanism that controls your flight, which in NACRA is actually your body, with some slight adjustments to the tiller and the sails, it's changing all the time. What you want is a nice flat platform to work on, and Portland Harbour is going to offer that. It's going to be a lot of flat water, so I think we should see a complete change in kind of the way they're sailing the boats, what we call the moding. So they might be looking at foiling upwind. Downwind, they're going to be able to push the boat very, very hard. Takes a lot of speed. And when you're sailing a three-lap short course like this, there's not a huge amount of time for strategy to play out. The key things are going to be good manoeuvres, very, very accurate with the lay lines. And in these foiling boats, the lay lines come pretty quick. So it's being able to sail the boat and keep your head out of the boat and do those simple things very well.
And it looks like some of the boats are just sailing off to the right of picture. Are we looking at maybe doing how you won your 49er World Championship, Stevie, starting underneath the pack on port and firing out to the starboard side, bearing in mind it's such a short course?
You're calling me a one-trick pony, Ricey. I don't know. At that time, it was a good trick to have, Ricey, I grant you. But yeah, I mean, I think at the end of the day, it's a short course, so the sooner you can be up to speed. On average, in this harbour, it's going to be about being on the lifted tack. It's going to be about sailing what the compass tells you is the lift. So they hopefully will have had time to do that before. In this pre-start now, my guess is you'd want to be on starboard with a hull, but for sure you want to have a clear lane, be going fast, and a very good option on a course like this is to start on port. And as you say, short course, then let's get the boat up to speed quickly, limit the manoeuvres, and being out on port can be a very good option. But who knows what the shift is right now? We don't know that, unfortunately.
We had heard the other day from the 49er FX when they had 2 days of racing inside the harbour here. There was a huge container ship up on the right-hand side, and there were a lot of good right-hand shifts on this race course getting into the right. Do you think this is a vastly different breeze direction and a different breeze condition today, Stevie? But do you think that maybe we've got kind of that half-half mentality, half the fleet sitting up here, 25 seconds to go? Clearly, you can see some of them bailing out and are going to have to start on port, but the majority of the fleet looks like they are actually starting on starboard and going to be wanting to go for that left-hand side with just 15 seconds to go.
I think the reality is, on a course like this, unless you've got nerves of steel and think you can shoot across the whole fleet on port tack, which would be a pretty stupid mood in my mind, you're going to have to go behind everyone by starting on port tack. So you're effectively, you're saying I'm behind. There you go, we're off and running. You can see, certainly look very brave on the start there. We'll see whether or not that's recall, but it's a pretty punchy start from people. But all these guys coming out on port now, they are fundamentally right now behind. So you've given away that distance. What you've gained by giving away the distance is you're up to speed. So we see how it pans out over time. But for me, it's going to be a very shifty course. And let's see how it plays out.
I think Stevie's got it nailed. That fleet was a little bit too punchy this morning. So we are hearing that they've got a general recall on the course today. I think that was probably led a little bit by the French boat there, who got off with a great start, but they sort of pulled the pack with them. And that was pack sort of middle pin, I think, that was punching the line a bit too early. So you can see the coach boats all getting back in there instantly, going for kind of the debrief of the first start. And I don't think that we'll necessarily see a black flag, but we did see that come out yesterday with the 49er FX and the race committee knowing they had to get so many races through the day. It's just different inside when you're in flat water and sort of the punchiness of the breeze strength right now. It's much colder today as well, so it's got that different feeling for the sailors in the boat park. They have to stay really warm, stay really geared up, and then to get out there and have flat water, you don't have the waves pushing you back. And in the catamaran, you hold your boat on the line quite differently than the 49er. We talked about the 49er a lot yesterday on the start line and how kind of easy yet hard it is to actually keep the boat in the positioning. What are the catamarans thinking when they're on the start line?
I think in many ways it's quite easy to hold the boat, because the boat, effectively, we'd always make a bit of a joke out of the catamaran sailors saying they've got a stabilizer by having an extra hull. So the actual holding can be quite easy in terms of a balance point of view, but the disadvantage of that is it's quite a lot less maneuverable. So making a very quick change is really quite hard, and turning one of these things around at low speed is really tricky. So I think you need to almost plan. We were talking yesterday about the 49ers being in position with three and a half minutes to go in that kind of breeze, and it's going to be the same if not earlier. When we came on board with Gemma and Jason, that was 4 minutes out, and they were already certainly quite aggressively defending their spot in their position, and that kind of jockeying to be on that front row and pushing out is what can lead to people being over the start line. So these boats are pretty spectacular, pretty nimble when they're up to speed, but at slow speed you've got to be very patient and wait for things to happen.
How come we got boys and girls sailing together in this, Stevie? Because we don't see that very often in any Olympic sport, actually.
Oh, I think that's one of the kind of great things about sailing boats, from my perspective, is it's so even, it's so diverse. For people of boys, girls, able and less able, and vision impairment, whatever. There's so many senses and sensations when you're sailing a boat that you can kind of get that variety. And I think having the girl and the boy in the boat gives a very different dynamic. I think it's fantastic for the sport to show that, that working together and upskilling everyone on the boat in different areas. But for sure, I've not myself been involved with an actor or anything like that, but it must add a very different dynamic, making sure that works very well and, understanding each other and going on this journey together is probably a bit different than two girls together or a couple of lads together. You're going to have to make that team work differently. But it's just, it's a unique challenge, as any Olympic campaign is, and we want to see that equality and that...
I would say maybe there's an inequality in the sense that, Jenny, it seems to be most of the girls that are doing most of the hard work on these boats. You wouldn't necessarily expect it to be that way around, would you?
I don't know. I mean, I think the point that this is the only co-ed class at the moment in the Olympics for sailing is an interesting one. Is there more room, as Stevie was just saying, in the future for more of the fleet to be co-ed fleet versus a men's and women's and one co-ed class? I think that's a separate conversation that could be had maybe even in the Magic Marine halftime show later between yourself and Ben Remucker. But it is a great sport for that reason. And I think realistically, Andy's point that the majority of the NACRA fleet is being skippered by men and the females are the crews and doing the hard work is valid. But Gemma Jones, who we're on board with when we're seeing the port tack view, the New Zealand view, is, I think, at the moment the top female helm. We know Sofia Beccatoro, Greek medalist in the 470, is also out there skippering. And I think realistically, down the line, maybe 10 years, we might see that the swing goes the other way and that teams realize that, unfortunately, men are still inherently more powerful, and so it might be the stronger move to have the females be the driver at the back of the boat, which is typically the less physical position. And yet, as we were speaking about yesterday in the 49ers, perhaps there is something to be said about having the weight in the back and having the height in the back. And we spoke about that with Pete Berling and with the young Swedes, Vilma, who is doing well in the female fleet, that sometimes maybe having that ability to offset with leverage in the back on a windy day offsets sending in someone with maybe less muscle to do the muscly work. So I think the reality is this fleet is still so new that we're not there yet. The teams haven't figured out what the creme de la creme is in terms of physicality, but it might be the case that there isn't a proper answer, that it is both sides even.
Which wouldn't be a bad thing, would it?
Exactly.
If there's a constant dilemma, if it's never solved, then really, obviously, it's not that big a problem after all. And men and women can sail either way round in an acro, perhaps.
Yeah, I mean, I've just come back from the Formula Kite Worlds in Lake Garda, and they're going to be racing in 2024. Absolutely awesome event. But we looked at a mixed relay, was the format they proposed. So boy races and then the girls race, or vice versa, or how you decide. And it's fantastic. And I think it's important that sailing as a sport keeps moving forward. And the NACRO is up on foils, super fast boat, does have a mixed crew. I think it's just great. And you can see here, looking at this start forming right now, look how close everyone is together. I think that's the nature of the catamaran. It is that little bit easier to handle at slow speed here if you're set up. If you're out of position now at 1 minute 30, you're probably already on plan B. And
so what's the Aussie doing here, lining up in front of our positioning down the eyeing down the start, just bearing away now? What do you reckon they're up to, Stevie?
I'm pretty confident that is basically they're taking a look, and they will have planned for a port tack start, probably double checking. You've got maybe a chance now. Can I tack in? You can see the Italian guy, or the French or Italian. Not very good at my flags or my eyesight, but there's a boat just tacking it into leeward now that thinks he's got a shot, thinks there's enough gap there to be able to hold from this position and start off the pin end of the line. And in fact, another Italian's coming underneath. So it's going to be very, very busy down at this end of the line. Probably in this situation, one boat's going to be over. Jenny mentioned as well, just a little bit up the line, you can see the Austrian boat poking forward. We'd always sort of say in the 49er, there's a danger spot, there's a hot spot. If you're in the bottom two or three boats towards the pin, it's very easy to tell, comparing yourself to this orange flag on the rib, where the start line is. But as soon as you're up the line, you've got to kind of use your racecraft, use your transits, gauging off the other boats, and you're putting yourself under more risk. So it can be quite hard to be that little bit up the line. But for sure, you can see the Australians come around now on port tack. And then if you are executing a port tack start, do you want to be out early? Do you want to be out late? It's a great sport, mate. There's a lot of options.
Well, 10 seconds to go, and the options are wide open at the moment. You can see one of the GBR crews, we're not sure if it's the current leaders of the regatta, but trying to win that pin with probably about 3 seconds to go at the moment. It doesn't look like they've accelerated too early. There is a punch in the middle of the line here. There might, again, be a general recall. Otherwise, I would expect whoever that boat is going to be over compared to the rest. And then there are about 5 teams going for that port tack approach, so going for the dip of the entire fleet, head out to the starboard side, head out to the right-hand side of the race course, and hope that they see that right-hander at the top. And I think realistically, we've actually got a couple more boats down on port near the boat in the line. But here we go. GBR 88 is not the current leaders. John Gimson and Anna Burnett. That's Chris Rashley down in 21st. They had a decent start. They're probably not doing quite as well as New Zealand 22. Gemma Jones, that looks to be almost maybe, Stevie, I would say the best spot on the line here.
Yeah, I think they did a great job. And a little bit like we talked about, really, it's that very pin end position. They were actually behind the line, but it looks like boats are turning back now. So everyone did look a bit over enthused in the middle of the line, which I think there's a bit of port end bias on the start line. So clearly starting down near the pin end is the gun spot. But again, probably only one or two boats are going to nail that. So when you're coaching or you're coached, you're told, let's be safe, let's get out in the bottom third of the line. But actually, that little bulge forward can be the most dangerous place on the start line to be. So that's why I think we're seeing quite a few people trying to shoot out on port tack, because it's, you're kind of, by starting on port, you're almost guaranteeing that you're going to be not over the line. You know, and you've got to at least start the race and to be in, to give yourself half a chance.
Is that why you did it, Stevie?
I did it because it's very good to go right racing.
Oh, there's other considerations.
I think regardless as well, we need to get them starting first at the moment instead of over.
What do we need to do to get them starting, Jenny?
This is clearly another general recall here, you guys, but I'm going to expect us to see a black flag now. I think they've had two opportunities with a U flag up. Again, the Americans here on board with Sarah and David just checking out the breeze. And actually, I think you can see her either telling him to slow down or saying that the breeze is coming down a little bit. But I think we could expect race committee to go black flag. And then I think the second that the black flag's up, we talked about it yesterday, there's a lot more trepidation, that sort of middle pack fleet. The second that someone starts to inch forward, the rest of the fleet doesn't necessarily go with that person anymore. The black flag and the danger of holding a DSQ, even if there's a general recall, is such a different danger to this, to just everyone's over at once, that the mentality normally does switch and we wouldn't see the 15 boats or the 10 boats that we just saw over early. And ideally, they'll get that black flag in there so we get some racing, Andy.
Well, just coming back to that start, Stevie, your favourite word yesterday was control. And we saw the fleet giving up the starboard end of the line, the far end of the line from our camera angle, and they were all fighting for the pin. We're on a short course, we're on a three-lapper in really fast boats. Why are they all fighting for the leeward end? Surely that's the end where you get the least control.
I think the difference from yesterday with this start line is that there is a little bit more bias to it. So to actually start up the line is harder. My priority here would be to be in charge of my first decision, be able to take the first shift. Okay, it's shifty, it's a bit less steady than yesterday. There are wind shifts. So if you can't get onto that first lift straight away, that's going to be a problem. And for sure, there is an element of risk by being at the pin. You've got a gun out, but because there's a little bit more port bias, so all the boats are going to find it harder to what we call hold a lane. So your bow is pointing more at the boat in front of you than just straight up the course. And I think what that means is it gives that person that does win the pin end a chance to really put the bow down, drive off fast and open the gap to make it happen. And again, starting on port, you're going to get yourself clear. And if you come off behind the fleet and you look and you say, I'm sailing a headed tack, right, bang, I can tack. And I'm straight on the lifted tack in a bit of clear space. And if you come out behind the fleet and you look at your compass and say, I'm lifted, well, you say, great, chances are the next shift's going to be a header. And also chances are, because I'm on a lift early on the beat, that means I've got time for the shift to come out. Okay, we're sat in a studio. We've got no idea how frequently it's shifting. Okay, but my guess is the shifts are quite quick.
Quite frequent,
probably every 1-2 minutes there'll be a wind shift. So we can expect to see a few more manoeuvres. It's only 0.8 of a mile. I've not watched a NACRA race before, but my guess is the beat's only going to take 5 minutes, you know, because they're shifting around this course pretty quick.
Yeah, I'm thinking 5 minutes is an overstatement
might be
at that
pushing
point.
It. Yeah.
But if it's that pin end bias, and look, I can see what you were saying, we only really saw 3 or 4 boats get a clean start off that end of the line. So is that a regatta winning start, or is that a high tariff start that you could well get badly wrong?
I don't think that's a regatta winning start, but I think the good start will come out of the middle of the line. But you,
on which tack?
I think it will probably come out of the middle line on starboard tack, especially now it's gone to black flag. So you now know that everyone's going to be a little bit safer. I should get a clearer view of my transit. I think these first two starts I would have started on port, because I know everyone's going to be aggressive on the line. I don't want to be over the line. I don't want to throw it away straight away. I want to get clear, look for an early tack. But now the game, if it goes to black flag, have you heard, Jenny? I can't.
We haven't actually heard, but I think that's the assumption.
You'd have to hope they've gone to black flag. So now we know everyone's going to be a little bit back. I'm going to have a clearer view of my transit. I can kind of change my approach to it. But again, we can't look up the course. I know that behind the camera here, so off to what we'd call the left-hand side of the race course, not where we're looking now. If they sail towards where we're looking on the screen now, the right-hand side of the course, we know there'll be just the Portland Harbour wall. So it'll be relatively clear in there. But on the left-hand side, there is the Noth Fort, which was the great spectator venue during the Olympic Games. And that can kind of bring you magic or bring you disaster, because you're not going to be able to see what's coming so well on that side of the course. And the guys will have done some practice beats and have a slightly better idea. I'd never be too afraid of the top left-hand side of the course in this stuff. You normally would get the good gusts coming over the Noth and hitting you. But we talked with Jenny and my comparison of sailing in a shifty day like this to snakes and ladders, it's actually a little bit different nowadays, and I think it's a little bit more like Super Mario Kart.
Okay. Well, does anyone else know what Snakes and Ladders is outside of the UK anyway?
Well, Jenny suggested no. Jenny suggested no. So,
maybe it's a British term. But everyone you know, it's knows a game that we play in the US. So it is a game that people are aware of. But the terminology of using Snakes and Ladders in the way that the British sailors or even British and Antipodean sailors use it is not a terminology that we necessarily use. So I had to explain it this morning in the Facebook podcast, but it's sort of the snake is when you get screwed in a hole the wrong way and you fall down the fleet, and the ladder is when you kind of end up climbing up miraculously, sort of the 14th to 7th that we were talking about yesterday, and maybe not miraculously, maybe very well timed ladders, but we don't really have as good an analogy for it. So it's an analogy that I really love, and yet every time that it's used I'm kind of like, oh, I know what it means, but I don't necessarily know that others do. So it's a hard one to say a Snakes and Ladders Day to an American, because they might look at you and go, right? Really?
Well, maybe Ben and I can play Snakes and Ladders in the Magic Marine halftime show.
I think it's a Super Mario Kart Day, so it's super mushrooms, rockets, or banana skins. And you want to get the mushrooms and the rockets, not the banana skins. So here we go, they're lined up. You can already see their way a bit further back. More of the boats here lined up on starboard tack, because again, if the whole fleet's going to be back a little bit, which you know on a black flag starts lightly, if you're on port, you're a little bit further back again from the line. So we'll still see some port tack starters, but you can see it's all much more orderly than it was on the first few starts, and that's what the black flag does. It makes it open. Up the line now suddenly doesn't look as bad. And here we go, we're up and running.
And you could tell there on the start, I mean, that was clearly black flag, because at 3 seconds, no one was accelerating at the gun. The line was clear. So we've now just got two boats. It was an Oz team as well as a German out on port. Everyone else starting on starboard and only tacking out, I think, at the moment, if they were disadvantaged. But an all clear start there from the race committee. And again, a great start here at the pin in the line, a different team. It's GBR 88. So they Actually, were the ones again. Who were most pinned last time, but were not doing as well as New Zealand, whereas here they've essentially crushed it.
Yeah, they nailed that start. It was a really great job by Chris. Interestingly, he's sort of in 21st overall, so probably will be approaching today with an attitude of, I've got it, now's my time to attack. I need to take it on and really get some top results, because we know Chris comes from the Moth class. And
then just underneath him, not such a great start for Ben Saxton. So sitting sixth overall, GBR 91, you can see, was deep off the pin and maybe late on the line and is now sitting in the bad air of his teammate.
Yeah, I mean, that's, you know, he's obviously very compromised there, but Ben must be pretty keen to get himself out to the left-hand side of the course. Although actually, if you look now, if he tacks, that looks like a bit of a minefield to try and dodge your way through behind the other boats there. So just shows you how important...
Is that what you call it? Mario Kart banana?
It could be. There's a lot of potential bananas right there by the look of it, yeah. He's got a few issues, I'd say. But he's, you know, he's clearly... What he has got now is he's been able to push himself through. He's being patient, which again is something you've got to do in these situations. We talked yesterday, you start a race and from that moment on you make mistakes. Well, he's made a bit of a big mistake at the beginning, but the important thing is not to then make the next mistake. It's to decide what's the next right move. Kind of guess that he must feel he's on a lifted tack. He must see that he's sailing towards pressure, sailing towards a nice magic mushroom out on the left here. And that's going to hopefully, he'll think, give him a speed boost up the course. But once you have made a mistake, the important thing is to bring the tempo in the boat down, stay calm, and allow yourself to, you know, to get the rhythm back and get sailing the boat smoothly and quickly.
And again, here's a look at our live tracker. It's showing Oz 377 out on the right. So that's Paul Darminian. He was the one boat that we could see starting on port behind the whole fleet, the first boat to actually get out to the right-hand side, and kind of, again, of course, the tracker here up and down with who's actually leading. But at least decent positioning, Andy, for him to look this good early on.
Yeah, I would say so. I mean, it looks to me like that port tack start underneath the fleet looks like a pretty strong play. I'm thinking that must be what Sofia Beccatori, the most far right-hand boat, Greece 470, has also done, and maybe also Paul Koloff and Stulema, the Germans, who are nominally leading at the moment. So early on, I would say the port tack start looks like a strong play.
Well, the Greeks, I saw Annie Lush in the boat park earlier. She was an Olympic women's match racer here, training for years in this venue that we have of the London 2012 Games, and what's been essentially a beautiful venue for all the racing this week. We spoke about it a lot, Andy, but fabulous conditions, everything from windy and shifty to, you know, what we're seeing now, light and shifty and light and solid yesterday. But I think Annie's probably got some inside knowledge and is helping Sophia and the Greeks to figure out which way to go. And if seeing them goes right, that might have been what the inside knowledge was this morning.
Could well be. I mean, it is a really tricky venue from this wind angle, I would have thought, Stevie.
Well, it's a shifty venue. I mean, the key is to sail on the lifted tack, to sail what you can see. I was coached a little bit by a guy called Morgan Reeser, and he's one of the more successful sailors in multiple classes, from dinghies up to keelboats. And you know, he'd just say, where's the wind? You know? Well, the starting point for our boat racing is we need wind. So if you look out and you can see a darker patch on the water, chances are that's wind. Right, more wind than where you are.
And he gets paid hundreds of pounds a day to come out with
stuff. I told you,
Rice,
it's about keeping it simple. Okay. You try and, with your journalism, try and overcomplicate it. We're trying to keep it simple. And I think that is the fundamental. Where can I see wind on the water? And today you're going to see lighter, darker patches on the water, and you're trying to link up the dark bits as best as possible. Now you throw into that the fact that the wind will sail you at different angles as well. There's shifts. And to me, what you'd often see in the UK, probably the Northern Hemisphere as well, is that towards a land mass, so as you go towards the land, the wind will tend to bend a little bit beneficially to the left. Okay, so as we get to the top of the course, then we'd expect the left to potentially give you some quite good shifts. So that's why, for me, I'd be happy to start on starboard, come out and move across to the left-hand side of the course. I mean, the beauty of starting on port tack, like some of these guys have, you're up to speed, you're full VMG, and that's the big goal. Only two or three were going to get that off the pin end of the start line, and by starting on port, you up your chance of getting that. But what you do then take away is you're putting a lot of commitment in the right-hand side, and we talked yesterday, first race of the day is often the learning race. So let's not, maybe, you know, let's hope the Greek girl does well, but maybe that's you're throwing all your eggs in to be the first boat off the on port tack. You're committing, the right needs to be best. So if I'm going to start on port, I'm going to start late on port, so I'm going to be somewhere near the middle of the course. And I think you saw Australia 46, Nathan Outridge was a little bit higher up on port tack. He was a bit nearer the middle. You're playing your averages. It's not the race winning move, but what it is a regatta move. You're trying to get this average score to be good.
Well, it looks at the moment like the best spot to be is that Italian team. You can see them just leading off the screen left there. That is Rigaratita and Caterina Banti. And they've had a decent week so far, but maybe not quite nailing the last couple days the way that they nailed the early days, Andy.
Well, yeah, but we are holding them to extremely high standards. I mean, let's not forget they're only 3 points off the overall lead. It's just that in 2018, they pretty much dominated everything, to the point where I remember Ruggero Tita and Enoshima and the final big event of the year, I think they got silver. He was so upset because he was so used to winning gold. Well, so it's not really that much of a surprise to see these guys doing well today. And I wonder how he has responded to losing the lead yesterday, because he seems sometimes to be an all or nothing kind of guy.
Well, I think if this is his response, I'd give it a thumbs up. Well, and again, he's not necessarily that far ahead of the guys who's taken over the lead. So John Gimson, you're seeing GBR 21, John and Anna Burnett just nipping on their heels. So in terms of, if this is the Italians' response to dropping, this is a pretty good, strong, solid defense by the Brits, I'd say, as well, Stevie.
Yeah, I mean, I think Andy's point is quite true in that, you know, the standards we're holding him to is quite incredible when you consider the opposition he's out there racing around with. There's an awful lot of talent. So to drop the odd race where you might end up with a tenth, we're criticising him for a tenth. Well, I'd be quite happy to have ended up with a day like he had, really. He's still right in the game, and as we said, I think yesterday's conditions, the big waves are a little bit unique compared to what the Nat Crusaders are used to, a bit more used to this flatter water, get the boats on the foils, and we can see them here. It's definitely not windy enough to be foiling upwind. They're powered up, they're well powered up, but they'll have to have hoped they've got their settings right for these conditions, and I've got to be honest, I don't want to show off, but I do think this top left doesn't look too bad at the minute on the camera angle, Ricey. So my boring middle upper line start, hold my lane to the left, I'd be still quite happy that I'm going to be in not bad shape. The Danish crew here got themselves a lovely lane and coming in looking quite fast. And of course, the unique thing with the Natca is they have the spreader leg. because these things are going so fast. We need to try and make sure the boats are a little separated. But I think we can say there, this top left has wound in pretty well. And it's the nature
magic,
of this.
Magic mushrooms you were talking about.
Well, yeah, or magic carpet. Who knows what's
maybe
going on?
The star. Yeah, what's better in Mario Kart, the star or the mushroom?
I think normally if you're doing last, you look for a rocket. But that's we're talking algorithms, whereas unfortunately in sailing, there is no algorithm to give us the answer.
No,
the
but
Danish
I think
have really executed that beat very well. Safe start, just up the line, held their way out to the left, and they've got themselves in a fantastic position.
Yeah, I think this is, you're seeing now second place overall, first place in this race. Lens Hintholt, CP Lubeck, Denmark 71. They have nailed, as you said, they figured out what the magic carpet was on that upwind, nailed the top beat to be.
And I think that was Chris Rashley going around
second.
He's come off the pin end. So,
yeah.
So what we kind of called as not a bad option for the course, we're not so far off. And now straight into this downwind, you just watch how much the crew's working here. So effectively those small steps forward and backwards, as we said, the helm at the back there has got it kind of relatively cruisy, just steering around, but those small weight movements forward and back are what's deciding the what we call the ride hat, how high the boat's foiling out of the water. A lot easier than yesterday. I imagine on board they're quite enjoying this flat water. The boat probably feels like it's going a whole lot quicker, but somehow while all this moving's going on, the helm needs to get their head out and look around. And on board the American boat there, Jenny.
We are on board the Americans, and you can see they've got their spinnaker up. I'm just looking for where they are in the tracker. And again, if you guys would like to follow on along with us on the tracker, I think today the easiest way to find it is from the 49er and the FX results page. It's just out on the right-hand side, and you can see everything we can see on the tracker. But I don't know where the Americans are at the moment, so perhaps their tracker is not actually telling us, because it's showing them sitting in last, and we saw that they're not last. They've rounded already. So anyway, back to Denmark here. It's interesting to see how they sit bows down when they're foiling downwind in these conditions. It's not necessarily the move you'd expect.
No, I mean, you know, the whole pitch of the bow, they'll have done their analysis, I'm sure, and decided that the foils work best with that angle if you can hold it, and there'll be an aerodynamic factor to the hull itself, and I guess that's what they found. What you're doing by getting the bows down is you're getting the back of the boat up a little more, and what that does is takes a little drag out of it by lifting some more rudder out. So there's, you know, they spend a lot of time training these things to work out what's quickest, and that'll be a performance based call based on drag, windage, and everything else that will make the difference, and just stability. Probably they'll find the boat flies better at that angle.
Yeah, I love thinking kind of like the car, the aerodynamics of a car, that when you have its bonnet, you might call it here, right? Close to the ground, and then it goes up from there. That's sort of what the knacker looks like when it's in that bow down, foiling downwind mode. You can see a lot of that is controlled and dictated by the crew. The skipper sort of nailed into their position in the back of the boat, probably in the foot straps even. And the crew has to be really dynamic, Andy, to be kind of constantly on their foot, both with the trim of their hands and with their feet and their body placement.
I think so. I mean, you know, just a small movement on the main sheet, on the tiller, on the spinnaker sheet is all changing the load going through the boat. And we can see the guys here on board the Kiwis here. And you'll see Jason now. He's moving his weight up and down, constantly small movements forwards, back. And, you know, I'm sure it doesn't feel quite as jerky as our camera's making it look, but it's not far from it. You know, there's small little twitches that Gemma's having to make on the tiller there. Same again, we can see there's a slight bow down inclination, so I guess that's going to be largely based on trying to remove drag off the rudders. But what it's also doing by lifting more rudder out of the water is making the boat harder to steer, because you've got less kind of accuracy with what's in there. So it's all really smooth movements, and we used to describe it in a 49er as, you know, as tomato, but you can see they're already at the bottom of the course here. You look at the tracker and we can see the Danish guys have done a fantastic job keeping it simple. Looks like they've gone to the ley line straight in, and let's see if they look for a right turn at the bottom to get back out to what they found to be a favoured side, or are they going to keep it simple, minimise manoeuvres, take a let? Nope, looks like we've got a jibe and they're heading back out to that left hand side. So clearly the leaders feel there was something out there. They've sailed a very simple course. You can just see how quick it is, guys. I mean, it's, you know, there's not an awful lot of time for decision making.
No, I think there's not even enough time for you to get your breath between the downwind and turning back upwind again. I think the 5 minutes of how long will it take them was more like 5 minutes for this entire lap. And yeah, a beautiful downwind run there from the Denmark team, yeah, to call that ley line so far out to almost the perfect jibes at ley line there, Andy.
Yeah, amazing. I mean, they've got so much else going on. I mean, the constant balancing to keep the boat at right height, keep the sails setting, and then also to have the presence of mind to spot a perfect ley line from so far out, bearing in mind it must be quite shifty and gusty out there. So just phenomenally good sailing by Denmark 71.
I think the interesting thing with that, Andy, is if you're going to approach a race day like this, you've got to decide what's important. Okay, so you've got to prioritise. There are so many little things to do, but when you're sailing around, the coach will have said to them today, let's be accurate with ley lines. Okay, so when he's come around that mark, and they've come around that mark as a team, first job is let's establish where the course is. There's no point doing a race if you don't know where you're going. So that was always a thing that was drummed into me when I was a kid. You've got to know where the next mark is. There's no point heading off like a rock star over there when the mark's 180 degrees the other way. And it's just prioritising. So clearly, yeah, you want to be sailing the boat smooth, fast. But they'll have probably said there's not an awful lot of tactics in this course. It's so quick, the downwind. We've just got to be really accurate with our manoeuvres, really accurate with our ley lines. And you can see how hard they're working there, Jenny.
I think the interesting part, there's not a lot of tactics here. But the big tactical decision is the split of the bottom mark. These guys clearly wanted the left side again. They went for the jibe. Behind them, Chris Rashley also went for the left-hand side. But out to the right-hand side, the German team, Kohlhoff and Stuhlmann, they went to the right on purpose. They chose that. Now, whether it's because they didn't want to sit in behind the others or whether because they wanted the right-hand side, but they weren't the only ones to go that way. You can see now the fleet spread here. The majority were picking left, but there were a couple of dark horses that went, I'll put my money on the right here. And they went far enough because they kind of had to, so they're not in this bad air position above the top marks, to clear out. And I think we might see a small gain here from the German team over, say, Chris Rashley and GBR 88, who's actually continuing hitching out on that left-hand side.
Yeah, I mean, we talked a little bit yesterday about it, but if you're in the lead, you get to make the decisions. Now, you might not make a good decision, you might make a bad decision. So there's an element of, you put the pressure on yourself by giving yourself the privilege of making those decisions. But the German boat behind, what's the play of the dice? You're trying to establish how much risk is there in me going to the other mark. And you can see they're coming back. They've come back to the middle pretty quick, as the Danish have. Both boats have taken early. They've had a look which way's best. The Danes have decided, okay, we haven't done too bad on the left. We've closed down with the Germans. We've removed any risk. You can see there's no boats to the left of picture at the moment. So there's no risk that side of me, other than the Germans that I've come close to. I'm going to tack back and lead to the left, where I believe is the favoured side of the course. So very sensible, controlling sailing there from the Danish. Chris Rashley's being a bit braver down to leeward, GBR 88 there. He's seen the left-hand side work for him. He's had a very, very clear plan. He's wanted the pin end in the general recall and then the start that went. He's nailed that, seen the advantage in it, and let's see if he can keep the boat going fast enough to make that strategy play out.
It looks like on the far left, Chris Rashley is just tacking right now. Chris Rashley, a very good moth sailor, come second in the world a couple of times in the moth. This is big moth sailing territory here, Stevie. You sail a moth. How much would Chris know this, would know Portland Harbour? Has he done a lot of sailing in here, would you say?
Chris will have done a lot of sailing. He was a 49er sailor way back, and he'll have spent plenty of time out here. I mean, I think, as I say, today like today, it's going to be a case of playing what you see on the water. You can have your ideas and your knowledge, but clearly every gust, every day is a little bit different, so you've got to sort of play what you see. And you're on board here with the Kiwis, and you can just see they've just finished attack, getting the boat up to speed, and as soon as possible getting our head out of the boat, having a look around. Jason there having a look around and letting Jenna really drive the boat and make sure we're up at full speed, because you can be the best tactician in the world, but if you're not fast, you haven't got the boat going fast enough, it's kind of irrelevant. You see it in a lot of sports. Formula One's a classic example. You can be the best driver in the world, if you haven't got the fastest car, you can look quite average. And so they've got to split the roles very well. And you can see here, Gemma's got really quite, oh, she's looking around now, but she's had a pretty razor focus on getting the boat up to speed after that tack, and then really allowing Jason to look out around. It's that dynamic, who's looking out, who's driving the boat, and making sure both of you aren't doing the same thing at the same time, you know?
I think I gave Gemma a bit too much credit earlier, saying that she was the top female skipper. In fact, they're sitting ninth going into today. In eighth above them, the Finnish Sinem is also a female skipper. And in seventh, that boat you're seeing just to their windward hip there, Tara Pacheco, again, a female driver there. And I think Gemma and Jason have done a really good job here. Well, it looks like they were doing a really good job of climbing to weather on that Spanish team. We saw that Spanish team kind of dropping out further and further. But in the last couple seconds there, right before we switched tacks, maybe it was actually a touch of a left shift, and maybe it did go the advantage back towards the Spanish again.
And talking of female skippers, we've also got Lynn Senholt and CP Lubeck here as well in the lead in this race as well. So, okay. So put, you know,
second overall.
Yeah.
In the lead in this race, and it kind of looks like they've extended. I mean, the two tacks to the Germans won and to the, sorry, the two tacks to the Germans won and the Brits won, you might have thought would drop them down a little. But realistically, you spoke about it earlier, Stevie, when you are in the lead, you can kind of afford to spend some extra maneuvers to be defending. And it looks like it hasn't hurt them too much at all. They're still solidly taking this race.
Yeah, and they're the ones that are able to pick their clearest course. I mean, it's the hard thing about today, we talked a lot yesterday about control, didn't we? And I said you wanted to be positioning yourself well to control. And all right, looking at this picture now, that's ultimate control. The two guys behind you are on your line on the same tack, and one's even to leeward of you. So that's perfect positioning, perfect control. But when it is shifty like this, that dynamic's got to shift slightly towards the fact of trusting yourself to sail what you see. And you've got to race the wind you're in because, you know, the racetrack's moving. It's not a 100-metre track. It's not just a case of the gun goes and I leg it as fast as I can down the course. The track's moving all the time. They're getting towards the top of the track here. And you've got to trust yourself to look out and make those decisions with the wind that you see.
Well, I think the one interesting part, as we watch the Danes really take this lead and put a commanding stamp onto the overall lead in this race, and realistically this will then also move them into the lead overall for the regatta. The points are so close in the NACRA. They were only 1 point behind John Gimson and Anna Burnett going into today, so this should at least put them on even and probably put them on winning after the moment. But that's now a good 10 or 12 bolt lead back to second place, which
Koloff, I think.
Looks to be Germany rounding here. Koloff Stulemer, and then only just a very, very close battle here to the Brits, who are Chris Rashley, not the Brits who are leading into today. But I was just going to mention that we're seeing the Kiwis actually take a double tack out there. So we saw them earlier. They were on port. They had decided to go back to the left one more time. We just saw it on the tracker. We didn't quite see it by eye. And I think realistically, that was what you were doing. That was what you were talking about, Stevie. They've just made their eye on the weather, and they thought that the left-hand side of that course was looking best, and they went for two more tacks to see if it would help them out. And I think the question is whether it has. They're rounding behind the Austrians here, but I don't see the Spanish in play at all. Oh, sorry, they're rounding behind the Spanish there, so it was lost to them, I think. Two manoeuvres was too many.
Yeah, and that's the compromise you're constantly playing here. You're lap two of what we think probably a three-lap race because things are happening very quickly on this course. And you're constantly making that compromise. Is the manoeuvre worth it? For the shift I see, and you've got to trust yourself. You're going to make mistakes on a day like today. The hard thing is to keep backing yourself. It's going to be hard for everyone. You're going to have some good bits, some bad bits, but the worst thing you can do is to start not trusting your decision making. You need a good reason for making a decision, but then if that decision is good, great. If it's not good, okay, let's analyze why, but let's not lose faith in it, because we don't know exactly the track. The wind that you see on the water can move a bit, and you can see this right now. The boat's coming in at the windward marker. It's crazy tight racing. We've got an Italian trying to squeeze between two boats and then shoot in. They're gonna have no rights here at the mark, so gonna probably have to go around the back. Two boats there attacking, but you can see it. Oh, that's, yeah, certainly some, brave.
And we've got some big names back in the back of the fleet as well right now. If that's Italy 26, then that's current third place overall in the regatta, rounding in deep, deep teens here. So it's been a tough race for those guys.
Yeah, I think it's going to be that kind of day, to be honest. Three laps, very short course. It doesn't quite lend itself to boat speed. I mean, you can see now that awesome boat speed on the Danish boat, maybe almost a little bit too much as it leapt out there, got a little bit too much lift on the foils. But it doesn't lend itself as much to boat speed. Often guys, someone like Ruggero, Tito and Caterina, you know, yes, they'll have sailed fantastically well, but the reality is I imagine they're fast. Yeah, imagine they've got very good boat speed, which comes down to huge hours of preparation. How the Danish can sail the boat as smoothly as this, hours of preparation and working on the boat, working on their technique to make it kind of look easy, doesn't it? But I'm pretty sure if we were out there, Andy, we'd be making it look like a right dog's dinner.
That's the shame of watching the best in the world, is sometimes they disguise how easy it is, because I think in most people's hands that cat would be a bucking bronco, wouldn't it?
Certainly we could make it look pretty special.
But talking about keeping it simple, Chris Rashley, hasn't he pretty much banged left on both beats? I mean, I think he's one-tacked pretty much both beats. He's kept it pretty simple. So there are simple options out there, it seems to me.
I think the key to today is on this kind of course is to be able to keep it simple. But if you're in the pack, that's not very, very easy, basically. You know, you've got to have a plan and you've got to stick to it. Now, the Germans here have obviously felt they had a little gain on the right-hand side at the bottom. They've taken a left turn, but also the Danish have that time.
Yeah, exactly. I mean, we talked about this at the last bottom downwind, that first the Danes and then Chris Rashley had headed left and the Germans had picked to go right, and it looks like the right was the advantage. So while Chris might be mentally making the easy moves, just go left every time, you then there's somewhere where you have to reset. And I think the Danes have done a good job to say, okay, the right did work a little last time, and we are gonna think it would have been much easier for them to not jibe around that mark there and to just head to the left one more time. But the Germans have closed the gap a little bit there. So when they're closing the gap, the Danes had to become defensively picking that left turn, that extra jibe, that extra maneuver on the downwind to set them up for starboard advantage, first of all, for control a little bit and your mentality a bit, Stevie, and everyone's mentality, and then also perhaps because the right's paying early, at least, if not later.
Yeah, I think because this left-hand side's been so favoured, the whole fleet, and it's a short course, everyone is keeping it simple. So they're all kind of coming around the Wimber mark, straight set. They're all coming down on port here. So if you do the right turn, like Chris Rashley and Co did, you're going to have to sail out maybe to the favoured side, but underneath the whole fleet. The Danish have come round the left turn. They've only gone a couple of hundred metres and they've tacked back in. You can see them in the back of shot, just through the back of Chris's mane there. So sailing's a compromise. There is no perfect race. You've got to make these decisions. I still think fundamentally, if you can get to the left and the top left, that's great. But it is a case of how you get there. And as you said, Jenny, the gain early last time was without doubt to get left clear from. You can just see so many boats coming down when Norwegian 348, Italy 98, Italy 26. They're all putting dirty wind onto anyone that does the right turn. So that's going to be a loss. But maybe in the long term, getting to the left is the gain. And this time, Chris Rashley gets to be the first boat going that way. Last time, he was following the Danish. And so he had a bit of a loss. And let's see. But there's nothing wrong with having an approach like Chris Rashley to keep it simple.
So that was interesting. Just in that final seconds there, we were seeing GBR 21 way back in the pack. And that's current leaders of the regatta. At this point now, no longer leaders of the regatta, but we hadn't quite seen what happened to them. That looks like they must have spun at some point in the race. What do you think's going on with John and Anna?
I think the first beat's so short. I mean, quite possibly there'd be a penalty. There's going to be a lot of interaction. We can see how close the boats are to each other. But I think what I would say is that it's just tight. And because of that, because it's tight, one small cross. We spoke a little bit to Pete Burling yesterday, and in his last race he said we didn't cross one guy by about a meter. We had to go behind. That then meant we had to go behind another 15 boats, and that so often just that 1 meter of difference can make a massive difference to your race. So there's every chance that John and Anna, you know, just missed one cross, didn't quite execute the perfect tack, and suddenly your options are very limited. And we mentioned earlier, Ricey, that, you know, it's not that big a course. So these speed demons, the guys that are fast and often can find a bit of space and then just go, right, I'm going to hit the accelerator. There's not really the room to do that on this course.
Which means that we're going to see a great test of overall skill across the whole week of racing here in Weymouth and Portland, because they've had their opportunities for speed. We've seen very different conditions out in Weymouth Bay on previous days, and now it's a flat water, shiftier test, and a great opportunity for some of the middle of the fleet sailors like Chris Rashley, just right of picture, to be able to make their mark.
Yeah, I think he's doing a great job, and yes, he's keeping it very simple, but let's remember he's coming into today in, I think he was 21st position, you know, so yesterday he had a 6th, 22, 26, so maybe Chris isn't quite there boat speed wise yet. You know, we know he's a very, very good sailor, got all the ability in the world, but maybe he's a little bit off the pace boat speed. So is his strategy good or bad? I think what he's doing is he's really keeping control of his decisions, giving himself space. And again, if he can come out today with 3 top 10s, it's going to be a fantastic day's racing for him, and will have really, really shown his skills. He's shown, right, I need to attack the race. I started at the pin end. You can see he's right in the match still. Yes, he's a little bit back on the Danish team, the German team, but we know they're top 10 performers. Danish are potentially going to be leading the regatta after this race. So, you know, you've got to know the hand you're racing with and do a good job. And I think Chris is doing a fantastic job of keeping the race and the decisions in his control here.
And he won the pin fairly easily, which really was the winning moment for him. He's not winning, but he's coming third, which is a great score for him. So it all comes back for Chris Rashley to that start. And he also won the pin on one of the recalled starts. I'm surprised that we weren't seeing the pin a little bit more hard fought for.
Well, I think like we mentioned earlier, there's an element of risk to it. And it can be hero or zero. Well, if you want to win the regatta, if you're putting yourself in a hero or zero position, there is the or zero, and you've got to make, so it,
the banana split
is right there on that boat, and so you've got to be brave. The other thing is he's done it twice. Now, if you want to start on a pin end like that, you need a good transit. You need to have practiced running into the mark and have done that acceleration a few times to know where is the perfect space to be. He practiced it twice, executed it brilliantly, and he can see, although he's not quite as close to the Danish as we can see on screen now as he'd like to be, great job by him, but a better job by these guys.
Yeah, I think interestingly, we've seen even yesterday in the 49er men's gold fleet, teams that you would expect to be able to nail that pin end start not execute it. We saw both Pete and Blair and Dylan and Stu kind of get hung up on the pin, get stuck on it, have to spin, things like that. So it is not an easy task, and I think maybe it's a tiny bit easier inside the harbour without the wave sets that we have outside, but we had this huge rolling waves yesterday, and you can see here, even though there's decent breeze, it looks quite flat inside, and it's a very different, we spoke about it yesterday, as the sailors like the challenge of being outside, because it does add that extra thought process to every maneuver, to sort of have to think through where you're going to tack or jibe on the wave set, how you're going to have to deal with that little extra dynamic. And here they don't have that, which makes it almost even that much more automatic. It's like the stick shift versus the normal of the car, Stevie.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, it is that little bit easier. What the problem they've got, and you can see here, the Danes look like they're going to have to do two quick tacks at the top mark. So they've, you know, that's a mistake. They've
roll
missed the lay line
as well.
But I think, yeah, a little bit of roll tacking. It's obviously really dropped the wind here. And again, that's what they'll have decided is the way to get that windward hull out of the water as soon as possible, keep the boat going fast, but pretty quick hoist there. But I think the one thing we saw there is the wind's very shifty. The fact they've missed that lay line, you know, if the wind was steady, that wouldn't have happened yesterday. They've missed it by, you know, two boat lengths. They'll be kicking themselves, but the reality is the wind's shifty, and that is what's hard. You've got to manage. You've got to be accurate with these ley lines. You can be very clever with your boat speed and your sail setting, but that two tacks there will have cost them three or four boat lengths. You won't get that in boat speed.
And the Germans have closed the gap, so there's not much of a gap between first and second. So there's an opportunity for Koloff, the German, to be able to attack, especially because look at the gap back to third. The third boat has yet to go around, and there's going to be a battle, a bit of a battle, and these boats are starting to get more congested. So the first two are really on a big breakaway right now. But it looks like Chris Rashley has given up third place. Is that the Kiwis? So they've moved up to third.
So hugely impressive here, both the Germans and the Kiwis to really punch forward, and the Germans particularly to be punching into that first place, at least fighting for that first place, whereas here quite a tight battle for third between everyone from the Kiwis to the Brits to the Argentinians, and then the Spanish just rounding here. The Spanish had an unfortunate upwind there because they were third at the bottom mark, so dropping to sixth. But at the moment, the tracker here, Scott, it looks like the mark set up might have just changed mark, so kind of looks like they're not rounding the mark. We know that they are. We've just seen it in by eye. But you can see the teams going downwind, really dealing with that battle of traffic on the port tack, on the port tack ley line, and not easy to then set a spinnaker and sail through all of that.
No, although you're on starboard and you've got to trust that those guys are the best in the world. So once you've picked your angle, it's kind of their job to get out your way. Most of these guys have got a big enough ego to set their line, aim and shoot, and tell them to get out of the way. So I'm sure there's a few heart-in-the-mouth moments, especially if you're the crew, and especially if you're a control freak like me, you'd be fairly panicking if they weren't going to get out of your way. But you can see here the Danish have done a great job. But they've kept it pretty simple. They've been, other than that windward mark, they've been good with their ley lines, and actually probably most important is to be accurate with your ley lines downwind. And they've been very good with that, kept themselves inside the course, and the gap you can see is massive. If you flick from here to the tracker, I think you'd see on the left of the screen we'll be about to see the Germans. So the Danes have put themselves in a fantastic controlling position, and those two boats are a long, long way ahead of the rest of the fleet. And the only sad thing for the Danish guys here is that you're only going to gain 1 point on second and 2 points on third, despite the fact that you're a long, long way ahead. There's no time benefit to finishing a long way ahead. If you win by a meter, it's the same as winning by 2 minutes.
And you can see here, it looks like, first of all, I had just rewound, and it looks like the Danish had jibed because the Germans were jibing, so that was a defensive move for them to then have breeze forward. And I think the Germans just attacking there, trying to sail a bit hotter, a bit faster, to try to see if maybe they can get forward on the breeze of the Danish. And it doesn't really look, Stevie, like they've executed. It just looks like they kind of sailed hotter just for no reason, yeah, because they didn't get there in the end.
Yeah, and I mean, you know, but you've got to, like we said, they've not really got much of a defensive responsibility because they're so far ahead of third, so there are opportunities to attack. And by sailing that higher, faster mode, you hopefully start to gain on the Danes, but you're at least going to make the Danes come up a little bit to match you, and you make the race a bit longer, which is what you're trying to do. You know, if you've got to catch up, you don't want the finish to come too quickly, but the Danes have done a fantastic job, as they did yesterday. Actually, if you look at the day the Danish had yesterday, they had a 2-3-1, and that looks there like another one. So you know, they're really the form boat.
Absolutely, they will move into first overall after that. The Germans coming across in second and still not that far behind, probably only about 10 seconds behind the leaders. So really good sailing by Koloff and Stulema from Germany. And then a big gap back to the next boat, which we think will probably be Jones and Saunders from New Zealand. And looks like Rashley and Giovanetti from Great Britain might have dropped back behind the Argentinians, but it starts to get quite busy. And we'll see the next boat come into shot fairly soon.
This is a team that we've had some time on board. So there they go, crossing through now, New Zealand 22, Gemma Jones and Jason Saunders. And again, still even in that bow down position, although it does look like the breeze has lightened up a little bit. But well done for them. They were battling at times there. We saw them in fourth, we saw them in fifth, to then be able to come across and take the third and be defending their position, or even hopefully moving up from their ninth place overall. And then here, a very tight battle. Argentinians just rolling over the top of the Brits on the finish line there. So I think they will take that fourth position from Chris Rashley, GBR 88, and then sailing in quite hot, the Spanish, who at points we saw were playing up in third, so dropping there to six. Just kind of final on that final upwind, it looked like, was when they made the big drop, Stevie.
Yeah, I think it looked like it went quite light on the last upwind leg, and it's very shifty, so if you get yourself in a good position, there's gains to be made. And we've got two, but I mean, it's just great how close these finishes are. How on earth the guys on the race committee boat call it, I don't know, but then fortunately that's their job, not mine. But it's really, really close. It's going to be that kind of day, I think. For anyone to put together a really consistent day today is going to be very hard, which I don't know where John and Anna are, or Ruggiero and Katrina, but they're certainly not right at the top of the list just now. So
should be coming across maybe soon. That might be them there. I think that was Bissaro, Italy 5, maybe that one. So they've been lying in the top few as well. I think they're in fourth going into the day. But yes, it's really mixed it up quite a bit, as you predicted, Stevie. So the speed merchants, those that rely on pure boat speed, really struggling. On the left of picture, you can see Italy 26, the boat that dominated last year. That's Tita and Banti. They were in third place. Be interesting to see if they've managed to hold on to third place after this finish.
You could just see there crossing through the line was the Outeridge siblings, Nathan and Haley. So sitting 14th overall. And again, that was about an 11th place. That's
Tita and Banti,
Italian 26. So not a great race for the overall leaders. And considering we won't have... Oh, we might now just take into account discards, because this will be race four for the NACRAs. So after four races of gold, every fleet will be able to then discard a race. So it should possibly change up the scores quite a lot compared to what we were seeing this morning.
And GBR 21, the boat that was leading coming into today, John Gimpson and Anna Burnett... still a long way back. You can see them top right of picture, the purple trace. So that's how far back the current leaders of the series are. But they won't be leaders once they cross the finish line in this race. That's going to be the Danes who won that race just now.
Yeah, I mean, you can see it's been pretty up and down. When you look at the quality quality in the freak fleet that's really quite well back. France 99 in the middle, that's the four times NACRA world champion, Billy Besson. You know, as you say, Nathan Outridge in 11th. Tita was back in double figures as well, I think. And basically, it's not easy. That's the simple fact, it's not easy. And as we said, what's often the case is the first race of the day, unless you've got a great playbook and you've done a fantastic beat, everyone is learning a little bit more because every day is different. All right, we could blow our trumpet and say we made a pretty good call, eh, Ricey? You know, we called it. But that's very easy, sat here from the luxury with no pressure and trying to make decisions. A little bit of a hectic finish there from the French team. But as all these boats finish now, now's really when the coaches, the crews themselves, is a big moment for them to reset. We kind of learnt a lot from that race. The settings have changed. So I know from the multi-hole sailing I've done, probably some of the settings on the battens and with the rig will need to be changed. You can see a few boats in the background there have actually dropped their mainsail. I imagine they're going to change their batten tension, try and power the main up a little bit. There's a bit less wind. Let's try and power it up. Some of them will be thinking, wow, we were on the wrong setting. We thought it was going to be windier. Some of them will be going, wow, I thought it was going to be good to go right. We should have gone left. Some of them, you know, there's a lot to be learned from this race, and this race will then set the pattern for the day. So normally we expect what we'd call the good guys, and we define the good guys as the people nearer the top of the overall results sheet, being able to then execute. They don't necessarily know the answer, I suppose, which is kind of really reassuring for all of us sailors that go out there and look at it and go, wow, it just looks like a bit of water and some wind on it. It's not, we don't see it like Neo from The Matrix, you know. I've always thought maybe Ben Ainslie sees it like ones and noughts and it comes down.
I thought
down.
You did, Stevie.
No, I see it like squiggly lines and just flick a coin, Ricey. But, like, you know, you can only play what's in front of you. You can't just see it like it is The Matrix, and you've got to make that, you've got to do that decision-making live. And they made some mistakes, but I really expect guys like John Gimpson, guys like Ruggiero, guys like Billy Besson, Nathan Outridge, all these sort of household, well, sailing has household names, but if sailing does have household names, they're them, to have a bit of a look at it, to go, okay, we need to get a solid start, we need to push ourselves out a little bit to the left, we need to be on our settings for 8 to 9 knots. That race has gone. I can't do anything about that race. I've got to rub it off. And here we go again.
I'm still laughing at Neo from The Matrix. I think it's Tom Slingsby that they say can smell the breeze, right?
You got a big nose.
Yeah, no, I don't know. I was laughing because when I heard that, I was like, oh, in Kiel, you can smell the breeze. You know, when the ships come from the land and it smells like farm, and when the right ships come and it smells like salt water, you honestly are well aware, but you're sort of too late if you're smelling it, is the thing. You haven't seen it by eye. So I think I'm going to think that through. The
Tom's a big guy, though, nowadays, isn't he? He's been doing quite a lot of eating since his laser days, so I think and he's in San Francisco a few weeks ago. I'm pretty sure the wind comes out of a few bakery shops over there. So
when you look at it right now, I mean, you actually can see the nice little lines of breeze and light air at the moment. As you look at the race course, it's different, of course, in the harbor, as we were talking about. It's much different in the northerly than what we were seeing yesterday. What we're seeing and what we can't see below the drone is the north the Noth hillside. That was such a beautiful hillside, and again, this is such a cool stadium for racing and for sailing, and it was an amazing place to be for the London 2012 games. It's been a spectacular test of skill for these guys this week, Andy. They've been loving it after a series of light air regattas to finally be able to stretch their legs, and coming out of a race like that, Stevie was just mentioning, there's going to be a lot of debriefing, but realistically, how do you think they're feeling about it? There's still just a lot of races to go before we get to medal race contention.
Yes, and I would have thought that everyone is still feeling that there's an opportunity for them to do well in the next race, regardless of whether they did well or badly in the race just now. And someone who's got to be thinking that way is John Gimpson, along with Anna Burnett, who have just had a shocker leading going into today after such a stunning day out on the waves yesterday, but finishing in the 20s in that race, I'm sure they won't be downhearted. They will just analyse what they needed to change, what they need to do differently. And I think the margins between success and failure are determined so very much in the first minute or two out of the start. And I still wouldn't know, based on what we saw, what was going to be the winning move for the next one. I don't know about you, Stevie. I mean, I really like what Chris Rashley did, just banging the lefty each side, but it does leave you tactically quite exposed to keep on doing that, doesn't it?
Yeah, I think so. I mean, it's high risk what Chris did, and Chris is in a position overall where he can sail with a little bit more risk. I think it's a case now of a full reset. You can see in the picture we've got around us here, there's a lot of Nacras with their mainsail down. And for me, that means we've got batten tensions being changed on the main. It's going to really change the shape and the power in the main. And all these little details are absolutely crucial. My guess is probably nearly half the fleet, by the look of the number of mains that have come down, have misjudged how quickly the wind was going to drop. We were a little bit surprised before the start quite how much wind there was, but fundamentally the breeze is kind of following the forecast. So it's a bit of a reset. We know what's coming ahead. I think it's a case of keeping it simple.
Well, we know what's coming ahead, and we also know what else is going on out there. So we can only cover the one fleet at a time. But as we spoke about earlier, the 49er men and women's gold fleets are both racing as well. We've got an update on the 49er FX fleet. And again, we had the two general recalls, so we're sort of 10 or 15 minutes behind on this NACRA fleet because we were delayed by their general recalls. But the 49er FX women were racing out on a further course, and we will see their results on screen soon. But we've got Martine Grail and Kayana Kunz, the Brazilians, still leading, but they had a fifth in that race, and they are currently dropping that fifth place. So again, not a bad position to be dropping a fifth from Gold Fleet, very different to John Gimson and Anna Burnett at the moment. Charlotte Dobson and Saskia Tidy, who had a great day yesterday but counted a UFD, have now dropped that over early. So they've moved up into second, but are tied for second at the moment with Annemiek and Annette Duets, who had not a great first race, so a 14th. And we spoke to them this morning. They were upbeat, but I think generally that team is much more cheery than maybe what we saw from Annemiek and Annette, her crew, this morning when we spoke to Stevie.
Yeah, I think they've clearly been sailing very well and on good form. But I think what Annette, we got to chat to mostly, she was saying a very different day, big change. And I think perhaps we can see that from a few of the top teams there. It's a little bit of a reset button having to happen. And great to see the American girls, Paris Henken and Anna Tobias, 13th overall, but they've won the first race today. So they've clearly figured out what's going on out there. And the fact you can see some of the single digits are lower down the overall result sheet show that we've had a little bit of a change of the game, a little bit of change of the pitch, and it's cool. I mean, that's what we want. You want a full test of skills, and I think today's going to give us that.
Yeah, I mean, I think in terms of talking about teams who have spent a lot of time training here, the two girls who just won and got second in that race, if you scroll further down the scoreboard as well, you see Julie Bossard, the French team, who's sitting 19th overall, were the ones second in that race. And Anna Tobias at the time was Anna Tunnicliffe and was training against myself for a long time. We spent numerous weeks and months, and they won the Olympic spot to race in the 2012 games here. And she probably knows Weymouth almost like she would know her home place in the U.S. And I think realistically, Julie Bossard, who competed for the French in the women's match racing in the London 2012 games, would be the same. So to see the two of those teams on a tricky, shifty day like today come to the top when they are deeper in the 49er FX and are maybe sailing a new class and have a little bit less time. We spoke briefly about Paris and Anna yesterday, how they got together late in the quad and haven't sailed together, and Anna hasn't really crewed in her life before. But to see them take on a day like today with the first and second and the French as well, I think that goes to show that there is a little bit of bias to teams who've spent a lot of time here, and it's good to see the fleet dynamics turn inside and out a little bit.
Yeah, I think it's great. And where the girls will be racing, if you get Google Maps up or Google Earth or whatever, and you look out, you've got Portland Harbour. If you look up, you'll see Weymouth Bay, and the wind's actually today coming off the cliffs. So we're in the harbour and it's pretty shifty, but if you go out into the bay, it's super shifty. So what that does is it probably takes it less about the fine detail of the handling, the starting, and puts it more on your racecraft. And Anna's got a gold medal, and she knows what she's doing.
But you know what's exciting to see as well? We're talking about teams who are we've moved on, but we're talking about teams who have a lot of time here. But we did just see that Vilma Bobak and Malin Tengstrom also got a top 10 in that race. They got an eighth in that race. So for not having spent a lot of time here, we know they won the Junior Worlds last year, which basically means they're still mostly juniors. They haven't spent the amount of time in Weymouth. And we know that they prefer the breeze. We saw Vilma sitting in the studio with us, and I don't think I don't think any of us height-wise is as tall as she was sat in that chair yesterday. So realistically, to see them be able to pull off an eighth, that's just, we called them shining stars yesterday. I think still that's an inspiring scorecard on the reason that they're blue, if you're looking at the scores, is because they are under 23 and they're in that age bracket. So it's good to see the young ones mixing up as well.
I agree, because you look at every other team in that top few and they've all won a major championship at some point. I honestly hadn't heard of Vilma Bobek and Malentane Strom until this week, and I didn't know that they were junior world champions from last year, so that's not to be sniffed at. But at senior level, they seem to have made a real jump, and they don't seem to be intimidated by the people they're surrounded by the Olympic gold medalist, by the Olympic silver medalist just two places in front of them, the reigning European champion just one place in front of them, and then behind them Ida Marie Nielsen and Marie Olsen, one of the best in the world also. So they're beating some of the best, and it looks like that those young Swedes have elevated themselves into the top tier of 49er FX racing.
Well, now we've got the complete overall results for the NACRA 17 after that fourth race of Gold Fleet. And as we talked about, there is now a discard. The Danish team are now leading 2 bullets, a third and a second, I think is a pretty strong Gold Fleet scoreline. I mean, that is exceptionally impressive. And if you look their entire week, nothing worse than a fifth. So that's just a dominant. That's an excellent regatta here for the Danes. And then behind them, as we talked about a lot in that race, quite a deep race for John Gimson and Anna Burnett, unfortunately for them, and a relatively deep race as well for the Italian team. So sitting the top three still close in the scoreline, 25, 26, 29 points. There's really nothing in it, Stevie.
No, there's nothing in it, but those Danish have certainly got their mojo on, haven't they? I mean, they are sailing fantastically. We saw in that race they've adjusted to these conditions instantly, and yeah, they'll, you know, you'll be in a great stage, but as you say, there's still a lot of racing left to go, and they're not gonna, you know, they can't do anything other than stay focused on themselves and keep chipping away. But right now, if you could have a scorecard like theirs where you're discarding a third, even though they're only 1 point ahead, in terms of the pressure and the weight holding over their shoulders, they're really in a very, very solid position.
And I think just to show the depth of the fleet of NACRAs here, in 10th place, that Austrian team, Thomas Ajek and Barbara Matz, they were the bronze medalists in the Rio Olympic Games. So to know that they're sitting in 10th here, and granted, we are missing 2 boats as well. We're missing the gold and the silver medalists, Santiago Longhi and Cecilia. Santi's busy this week. Jason Waterhouse and Lisa Dominin, because Jason, I think, was injured recently in the CLGP. So there would even maybe be 12 teams or 20 teams that we can see are really close in the score lines. But to see the Austrians, the bronze medalists, sitting 10th and 40 points off of first, I mean, it's just a huge credit to the guys who are kind of not running away with the top three, because it's still really close, but to the guys who are further up the top of the score line, Andy.
Yeah, I mean, those three, and I would say Gimson and Burnett have really made a move forwards in 2019. They were knocking on the door of greatness in 2018, but they are making important moves at a serious time in the quadrennial. Ben Saxton and Nicky Boniface in 7th place, they've been the form team, I would say, for the past few years, as far as British NACRA sailing is concerned, but It's very much a two-horse race now, and it's moving in favour of Gimson and Burnett at a critical phase in the season for them. But the rest of the fleet will be encouraged that the Italians aren't running away with it quite the way that they were in 2018, when the Italians were just so dominant. It looks like it's a much more open fleet than it's been.
I think this race course lends itself to being pretty open as well today. It's so short. You've got to make a strong start, a strong first decision, and can you be able to put yourself where you need to? You've got to maybe be a little bit more punchy. It was hard to see exactly where the Danish started, but we saw from Chris Rashley, he was aggressive. He was second at the Windward Mark, despite maybe being someone that hasn't quite got that race-winning boat speed. He sailed a race-winning strategy, and if the Danish keep pushing on like this, you're going to have to change yourself to maybe being that little bit more aggressive.
So for all of you following along online with us, please do make sure, go click your answer for a poll of the day. You can find this on the front page of this event website, of the 2019 Volvo European Championships website, and you can see it just over there on the right-hand side. The poll of the day, you guys, greatest accomplishment in sailing. Is it Elvstrom? Is it Ainsley? Scheidt? Outerige, Burling, or Lange? I think it is a hugely interesting question. Stevie, your thoughts?
It's a hugely interesting one. I would, for me, it's quite easy. I would go with Paul Elvstrom because what he did for sailing, you know, I don't know if you've ever read his book, but it's a fantastic fantastic thing to buy off wherever you buy it, but just a great read, and what a story. I mean, he came second in a 505 World Championship where he was helming on the trapeze. He couldn't speak to his crew, who was an Australian guy he took up, and it says in the book, which is possibly not politically correct anymore, but he says he understood the paddle. So I guess it was two taps on the head was hoist a spinnaker, two taps was drop it, I don't know. But for me, he's kind of... he's from a different time, but anyone that's inventing weight jackets by just falling out of the boat in the middle of winter because you've been out training, jibing downwind, having walked across the ice, he gets it for me. But yeah, I mean, I'd quite like to have any of those guys' records.
Well, I can hear the Beef Eaters marching down from the Tower of London right now. They're going to march Stevie Morrison away.
And so Ben's nicer than that. He won't mind.
No, you're going to be beheaded in the morning. So here we are in Weymouth, the place where Ben Ainslie won the last of his gold medals. And so as a Brit, I have to say Ben Ainslie. Sir Ben Ainslie, I should say Sir Ben.
Yeah, careful, mate. You just called him down for me. You better watch out.
But I, in terms of overall impact on the sport, I agree with you, Stevie, in terms of not just being a great sailor and a great racer, but a free thinker, almost the Einstein of 20th century sailing, and some of the developments that he's brought to the sport, I would say Elvstrom. I wonder if Russell Coutts would be a little bit miffed to be left off that list. There's another one. You could go on and on and on, but they are all worthy recipients. All the ones listed there.
You know what's interesting? I wasn't gonna throw my hat in the ring at all because I think these are all such legendary names in the sport. I mean, really, truly, legendary names of the past, the present, and the future still. So I think in general, I couldn't say whether or not I would pick one single individual over the other. But the question, as I'm reading it, is greatest accomplishment in sailing. And so I am going to throw a little hat in this ring in that I don't think I've ever... Now, there's moments where I felt emotional watching sailing, and I can think of a couple, but in the Rio Olympic Games, when Santiago Lange, at 54, having just overcome lung cancer, having half of his lung removed and getting back into, you know, and I'd step back into 49er FX sailing in the Buenos Aires World Championships, and I watched him struggle every day to go out and sail for 15 minutes as he was getting over this recovery, and he was putting the time in to rig the boat and de-rig the boat and go sailing for 15 minutes and the next day 17 minutes and the next day 18 minutes, and to see him in front of his sons who were also racing at the Rio Olympics and with such close, incredibly tight racing, and then to have like penalty turns and whatnot and have it all decided on the line in that medal race in Rio and to take the gold at 54. I think I wasn't going to throw the hat in the ring, but I'm going to go greatest accomplishment in sailing. I think that was just such an incredible and impressive moment. And unfortunately, Santi's not here, and I'm sure he's not watching this because he's racing 52s. But anyway, that's it. We've got 2.5 minutes, and I'll leave you guys with that.
No, fair enough. That was a good one. But I think what's great, we've got some pretty famous people watching us today. I've just had a text message from Hannah Mills, and Olympic gold medalist in Rio, silver medalist here in London. And me and you might be safe from the Beef Eater, because whoever's in charge of that notice board has only given Ben Ainslie 3 gold medals. And he's actually got 4. Yeah. So Hannah just texted in. So thank you, Hannah. I think you're coming to join us in the studio. So maybe you can sharpen up the notice boards a little bit for tomorrow. But Ben has got 4 gold medals. Doesn't change my opinion. But it's amazing. Like I say, any of those accomplishments are quite incredible and great as well. We've got Nathan Outeridge, who made that list. He's in this fleet to the left of screen. Out to sea is the 49er fleet with Pete Burling and Blair Tuke. And they're out there as well, who are, you know, on that list with amazing achievements. So great to see. Interesting. Now we've got a slightly different. Looks like they've put a bit more starboard bias on the start line. Looking at where we're looking straight down the line here. Credible shot from the drone pilot. Well done. And it looks like there's a little bit more starboard bias on the start line. Most of the boats are up at that end of the line. Kind of changes the game a little bit.
Well, we've got nothing to look at because of that. I mean, it's amazing just how different the perspective is now. Just a little bit of line bias change and suddenly they're not interested in our end of the line anymore. It's quite phenomenal how bunched they are up towards the committee boat end. And I wonder if the race officer is looking at that and wondering if he's put a little bit too much right-hand bias in, or maybe we're just in a bit of unexpected right phase shift right now.
Yeah, I think possibly there's a little bit of right shift. Again, pretty hard for us to tell, but I think what happens on a short course like this, as soon as you throw any starboard or even equal line on it, then there isn't a runway for someone to start at the leeward end of the line, get far enough forward and be able to complete attack. Yesterday we talked about a 2-3 boat length loss in a 49er. It's probably more 4 or 5 boat lengths you're going to lose on attack, maybe not quite that much, but it's a significant, you've got to gain a lot of distance forward to be able to get that attack in. So the control, sorry, back to boring control mode, you've got an opportunity to get some control at the start on this kind of start line, and a lot of the fleet are trying to take that.
It's 20 seconds to go and the boat's charging up this end of the line. I wonder if it spotted something late. It doesn't look that biased to me. I just wonder if there are opportunities up this end of the line after all.
Well, why not? I mean, you know, if they've run out of plan A, then let's get ourselves well up the line, have a look, and maybe we can see a little bit of magic from the German team.
I think that's Johannes Pölger. He's often the ones with the huge Audi sponsors there, and I think realistically, yeah, if you're so far down the pin and you're going to give up that much weather leverage, you might as well try to go for the port tack start, and you might as well try to cross the fleet. And the question here, are they going to be able to cross the fleet? Are Johannes and Carolina Werner going to make it? And I think, realistically, yes.
Go on, Germans. That's what we love to see.
He's certainly got big summing there, and it looks like a left shift, I think, because he's just maybe squeaking across. It's going to be squeaky bum time now. Oh, wow. Well, there you go. I think he's good, but I hope they give it to him because
they deserve to win the race right there.
He deserved to take that on. But of course, you know, interesting, a fantastic start, one great party trick. Now he's got a decision to make. Am I happy continuing towards the right hand side of the course, or do I get across the bulk of the fleet and consolidate my position? So, yeah, fantastic. Saw the opportunity. It is shifty out there. Things are changing, and you've got to keep your eyes wide open.
Well, if it is shifty and they were on a well, actually, the Germans starting on port tack, maybe it had shifted back to the left. But we see now Sofia Bekatoru and Michael Patanayotis, excuse my colleagues in the Greek studio here, Greece 470, they win this side of the course, and Sofia Bekatoru, the gold medalist from Athens 2004, looking over her shoulder, looking at opportunities to be able to tack across.
There's a reason she's got 470 as her sail number, aren't there?
Living on old glories there.
Yeah, well, we all try to, don't we, Andy? That is for sure. But again, fantastic. Yeah, I mean, great to see her back in the boat. She had a few years away from the Olympic sailing scene. You know, one of the great sailors. And I think that's where this NACRA is so great. It's a fast, exciting boat. The opportunity to sail in this mixed team is absolutely great. And she's done a fantastic job on the start, stretching out. Interestingly enough, she was the boat furthest right in the first race. So perhaps got the best look at the right-hand side of the course. Didn't like the look of it and has changed up the strategy fairly significantly.
Yeah, from bouncing from one side of the course to the other. But looking quite good here at the moment, if they get an opportunity to be able to tack and cross the boats on their hips, such as the Argentinians and the Danes.
Yeah, absolutely. I'm waiting for that. It's time to be patient now for the Greek team there. That, you know, they've made their call. It's a strong call, like in the race before, but you've got to be patient. They don't want to be ducking behind too many boats right now. And we can see a big fleet in the split in the fleet. That can be normally affected by all the guys that are on port tack now probably couldn't hold their lane and they've been forced to tack away, and then they'll be looking to come back and make decisions further up the race course. But you could pretty much throw a straight line across the whole fleet there, and it's, other than the Germans who pulled off that quite awesome, gutsy, to say the least, gutsy start.
It's a phenomenal reward that they've earned for taking that massive risk of just squeezing across the fleet on port tack, and I just love it when someone takes a big risk and it pays off like that.
Exactly. We haven't seen a lead like that in the first upwind of a gold fleet race yet. We've watched a couple races now. This is going to be 6 yesterday, 2 today. This is race 8 of us watching 49ers, FX and NACRAs, and I think really, hopefully for those guys, they'll be rewarded with a race win, because that was an impressive to split from the entire pack who were up near the boat end, who were wanting to start near the boat end, to already have that, you know, we're going to be at the pin, and then to go, all right, go for it, we're going to be on port and we're just going to nail it and we're going to get across. And I think really realistically the only team we saw was a question mark that they were crossing is these Argentinians, and whether the Argentinians let them go or whether they actually just got across. I did do a little very fast rewind on the tracker, and it didn't look like Argentina's course changed much. So I think realistically, I think that's for Johannes and Carolina to put in the bag that they nailed that Portec start, and hopefully they've got the lead the whole way through the race to reward them for it. But here we go. It looks like the majority of the fleet from the left has tacked over. I think we'll see as they come together that big split coming back and merging near the top of the mark, which side's paid. But for the moment, it's not really easy to tell. There's not a lot in it.
No, there's certainly not a lot in it. I mean, I'd be a little bit concerned for Johannes and Carolina that this left-hand side's where most of the people were wanting to come. And you can see these guys up here have got the hull nicely up out of the water, kind of looking pretty quick. I like the lucky left often on a day like today, and the boats that have been able to hold their line out this way. The French team in the middle there, very hard to read the sail number, but you can see they've got the hull nicely up and they've got the boat going fast. But it's shifty. There's plenty of runway to go yet on this course. And I think you can see here, I think that's the Australians coming back across there from the middle of the course. So it's fairly, it's pretty tight. I think it's going to be pretty tight come the top.
Yeah, it's going to get busy up there. But you could well be right, Stevie. It does seem like even in this softer breeze, the light at the left seems to be the safer bet.
Maybe on average. And what they've been able to do, what can be a bit of a mask on all this is the faster guys, the guys that have had a good start and held their lane. We've got to remove Johannes from this because he pulled off a real party trick, which was great fun to see. But you're not going to do that every day of the week. So the guys that are out on this left-hand side are the people that started on starboard and had the boat speed and the gap to hold their lane. So that kind of means they're ahead anyway. And then let's see how it plays out, whether their side's paying or not. But it can mask a little bit whether one side's favoured or the other by the fact that it's the faster guys with the better starts that will, by the nature of positioning, end up towards this side of the course.
I think removing Johannes from this conversation, as you just said, is accurate, because we are removing him from the lead on the tracker as well. It does look like the fleet from the middle left has crossed that fleet from the far right. So the Germans, although they nailed the start, they didn't tack back early enough, and they've lost the lead overall. The question will now be whether that fleet middle left is going to cross that fleet that went top left and far left. And I think realistically, Stevie nailed it, and today is lucky left, and it looks like the guys who went furthest left ended up at the top left-hand side will be leading at the top. Now we've got Austria 3, so a different boat now with the onboard camera. We were speaking about them earlier, the bronze medalists in the Rio 2016 Olympics. They were sitting 10th going into today, and at the moment they're sitting about 5th overall on the tracker. They were part of this middle left pack, so I think you can see how much lighter it is now, really, how much lighter it's gotten since fully trapping in that first
race.
Yeah,
it looks an awful lot lighter, and there's a chance here that they're really trying to squeeze up to get around the mark. We can't see exactly where they are on the tacking now, so clearly a bit of a last-minute decision. It was getting a bit lighter, and you can see how close it is there. They're just really, really close at the very top of the course. The tracker shows them going around now, and hopefully we'll be able to get in to see that. But it's the French team, so that's Australia 377, Paul Darmain and Lisa, is it? Coming around the top of the course there, and they were the ones we saw coming across the middle. So they've been able to keep themselves clear, sail the lifted tack, and they've done a pretty nice job. But basically, there's your Greek team. We saw they were going well out to the left, so they're well up at the front of the fleet, gone around in sixth there. So I think, again, being able to have a good start, hold your lane, and get out towards this middle and left of the course has been a fairly safe overall strategy.
So again, we were seeing GBR 91 there, but that's not the guys who are winning. That was Ben Saxton and Nicholas Bonifacio. I think, again, we're seeing a tough race here for John and Anna, who were leading going into today. So there are not two discards in Gold Fleet. Once you get in, it is just one, and that's it. So realistically, we've got to be seeing some comeback soon from that's actually the Brits just there in sight. And then behind Germans, we saw them round about ninth. So that Portec start, that leading out to the right, was not the race lead. That was in ninth place. Whereas the French, France 81, we didn't even really see them off the line. I think they probably had a conservative middle. Your favorite spot, Stevie. Middle.
Boring guy.
Boring guy. Yeah.
But certainly those Germans had the opportunity to go where they wanted. They just made the wrong decision halfway up the beat by the look of it. They carried on too far out to the right. They didn't listen to Stevie about the lucky left. That's what they should have done. But it's surprising to see how quickly that lead that they had from that fantastic start has been swallowed up.
That's the thing with fast boat sailing, and these things are really, really fast, is if you get in a gust of wind, you're going 2, 3, 4 knots quicker than a guy, that, especially if you end up with two holes in the water and a lull. So being able to look out, spot the breezier bits. Again, here you can see the Australians have cut across, looking to find some clear air. But most of the fleet in general are trying to keep things really simple. Limit the manoeuvres. The course really isn't very big. Let's keep things going as fast as we can.
And you can just, for seconds here, there you can see how ugly it is to jibes if you have bad air. That horrible sailing upwind while on the downwind angle of Germany 77 was not looking good for Paul Kohlhoff earlier, but... Australia 377 just driving in here. I think that was a decent lane for them to go. They actually looks like they got a header as they were sailing along there on port jibe, so not too bad for them coming across. Still going to be behind France 81 and the Italians coming back from kind of a mid-fleet race last race.
Yeah, the Italians, I mean, I think, again, a bit ominous. I imagine the Australians jibed because they had the Italians right behind them, and looking at the speed that they've gone down this run on the Italian boat, he's got his wheels back on and he looks fast, and I think that's, again, if you used to be in a front runner like he is, he's probably very good at that decision making and using his speed and making the gains when he's at the front. Not so used to having a fist fight, you know, and you can kind of you can have the best boat speed and all the rest of it. If you're in a real dogfight in the middle of the fleet and you haven't had to practice that for a year or so, you know, maybe you're not quite as good at it as you used to be.
I'm predicting a straightforward race for Teter and Bounty. I'm going to stick my neck out, but looking at the other teams around them, they're not normally top-end teams that are fighting for the front of this race right now. So I think Teter and Bounty have lots of opportunity to move ahead and nail a race win in this one, which is what they need to be able to get back on in contention with the Danes, who won the previous race, not doing so well in this race, and nor are John Gimpson and Anna Burnett, who were our overnight leaders. So here's the opportunity for the Italians to go back on the attack. We see the Italians coming out towards our picture on the left-hand side of the course. The Aussies, Paul Darmanin, going out to the right-hand side. So Teter and Bounty going out to the lucky left. Stevie?
Well, they've been forced to tack. I mean, of course, the problem they had there was they were second. They were behind the French team. And so the French team have done an excellent job rounding the mark and have forced sailed a very high mode. So by that, they mean they're pointing quite close to the wind. Obviously, a boat will only go so close to the wind before the sails flap. And one of remember Andy's favourite coaching points when I was younger was a flappy sail is not a happy sail. So if you go too close to the wind, that's what's going to happen. And the French team did a great job, sailed a high mode, get themselves a powerful position, and they forced Ruggiero and Carolina to tack away. So let's see how that works out here. But again, the power of being in the lead is you get to make those decisions and you get to have control. On board the Austrian, you can see here he sailed a nice high mode, and actually the boat behind him there will be in his dirty wind. So we'll be getting slower. We'll be, you know, being slowed down and really affected. And out of these leeward marks, you need to have a different technique. You need to be able to sail the boat as close to the wind as you can and keep that speed. And in fact, that's the Olympic gold medalist from 2004, Sophia, there, having been forced to tack away.
It's nice. Good. Just to see the different manoeuvring now that it's getting lighter. I mean, I think the race wind, he's actually done a good job. We were questioning it yesterday that we needed to go an extra hour early today if the breeze would really drop off that quickly. And I think we were maybe questioning it again in the boat park this morning when it felt really breezy when they were all going out. But the reality is it has kind of dropped down quite soon, and to be middle of race two and have them kind of already trapping in the boats and have the whole dynamic be different at points. And yet now you can see also fully trap using it at other points. It's a hard transition period on these guys.
Yeah, and I think you'll see, you know, if you're in a gust, you're just twin trapezing like Moana and Noé from France are there. They're going to have the boat going quite nicely. They're in clear air. They're ahead of the fleet. Get to show, you know, what they can do with that clear space and get the boat up and running. But if you fall into a hole, so you find a banana skin, if we're using using my terrible Mario Kart analogy, then there's going to be massive differences to make. You can see here coming across, the Australians got the boat really wound up, hull out the water, and in a good gust. Again, hard to know who's on the better shift, but from what we've seen, the Australians coming this way towards the top left, maybe in pressure, it looked like, could be quite good for them.
Seems like there is generally a little bit more pressure on the left-hand side, and so maybe that is the better bet. Even as the breeze softens, it still seems like left generally is the stronger play.
It hasn't seemed bad so far. I mean, it's very hard sat in here in a studio to know exactly, but on average it's not been good. And you've got to weigh that up. The French team, you can see on the tracker here, they're pretty well left on the course anyway. And there does come a point where you don't want to do too many tacks and jibes. You start doing it every time you tack, you lose X amount of distance. You need a very good reason to do that manoeuvre. So the French are doing a pretty good job of keeping this race simple. Good Lewis Mark rounding, force the Italians, who we know are very, very fast, but force them to do two extra tacks. You can see the Italians are now the most left boat in the fleet. So they've tacked once away from the French and then had to tack back out to the left. So they will have lost four boat lengths on the French for sure with the manoeuvres. And then let's see how they've done positioning wise. But you know, you're trying to limit your manoeuvres, keep yourself in the best wind and stay clear of other boats. So it's not so easily done, and it's very, very, very hard to do that if you're back down the fleet. I think you can see Ben Saxton there, GBR 91 in the background. He's in a good gust of wind, got the boat wound up nicely, him and Nicky Boniface. And they're going well, but they're in that pack. I'm not sure exactly where they are in the race, but they're probably in that area, 5th to 12th, where it'll all be very, very tight. And a couple of metres here and there will make a huge, huge difference.
I'll just really briefly update us on the 49er men's racing. It does look like, if you're following along with us online, you can go click refresh. They have had their fourth race at Gold Fleet, their first race of the day today. The leaderboard's still much the same from overnight, although Dylan Fletcher and Stuart Bithell have moved up to third from fourth. But the Spaniards, Diego and Iago, still leading. We spoke to them this morning. They were very happy, all smiles on board. They'd moved ahead of Pete and Blair from New Zealand yesterday, but nothing in it, just 4 points there. And then 10 points back to third place, Dylan and Stuart. 3 points, 1 point. So all very close in the men's racing. You can update it yourselves, and unfortunately they're racing at the same time, so we can't cover both fleets at once, but we will see them again tomorrow.
Yeah, absolutely, and certainly looking pretty good there, Dylan and Stu, up to bronze, and all single digits so far in the Gold Fleet, which if I was in their boat, I'd be feeling pretty happy with, you know, a lot more races to go. But get to the Windward Mark here anyway, the French team. So that's Noé going tacking around the mark there. Moana and Noé tacking around the top mark. What's this? Top of the second beat, isn't it now? So the fleet's spread out a little bit, and they'll be hoping to be able to stretch away. They've kept a bit of a gap over the Australians, and you can see Ruggiero's not really been able to chip away. That again, I think that was a lot of the control that the French managed to exert around the Leeward mark and forcing the extra two manoeuvres from the Italian world champions.
Yeah, I wonder, going back to that rounding, whether they made the wrong decision, Stevie, to go round the same mark as the French and then being forced to tack away quite early. Maybe they should have gone round the opposite mark, but maybe the Aussies would have been giving them the same problem there.
Yeah, I think, I mean, as we say, it's a compromise sailing a lot of the time. There is no perfect race to be sailed. You're trying to make the best of the situation you're given, and sometimes the right decision is to follow. You know, there's again another sort of thing I would say is sometimes the next correct tactical decision's in the next race. You've got to do the right thing. Yeah, you can't magic it. If the French guys made the right call, which Moena and Noé did, and that is the right call, well then your correct call is to be second and to stay patient. And so I think Ruggiero they've done a very good job there. You see the Argentinians working pretty hard,
and they've had a good day so far, haven't they? I mean, they're sniffing around the top 10 in this race. I think they were fourth or fifth in the previous race, the Argentinians having a very consistent series, whilst we're seeing some of the other front runners bouncing from one end of the fleet to the other.
Yeah, it's a hard day, isn't it? I mean, it's a short course, it's shifty, it's flat water, it's getting lighter. All the factors that kind of bring in the consistency or a change up in the fleet, if nothing else. So there are people being consistent, but things are happening so quick that if you don't execute the basics with a good start, good lay lines well, then you can quite easily lose a lot very quickly, and it's hard to make it back up. As soon as you're 10th, 12th, feel like you're gasping for air when you get to the Leeward mark. There's so many boats and sails going upwind, downwind, and you've got no choice. So you're kind of following and you're just taking the decisions you want. But it's great to see on board here with the Austrians and see the boats in the background. There might only be 6, 7, 8 knots of breeze, but they're up on the foils and probably doing 20 knots still downwind.
And if Barbara Matz had her Fitbit on, she'd be notching up a lot of steps, wouldn't she? I mean, that's a constant movement there.
Yeah, I mean, I don't know if Austria has strictly come dancing as we do over here in the UK, but there's some pretty tidy footwork going on there. So she's clearly having to sort of dance her way up and down the bow and just look at the, you know, look at the precision that, that she's needing to use to keep the boat. They're trying not to move the sails too much. If you watch actually where their hands are, they're keeping that sail. Because if you move the sail, you're changing the downward load on the boat every time you move it. So if you're doing that and you start changing too many things, then it becomes very hard to fly. So got the sails really locked in, unless, of course, the wind and the speed in the boat changes too much. And then it looks like a bit of a two-step, Jenny. You're probably better versed on your dancing technique than me.
Not a dancer at all. Might be from Texas. There might be something called the two-step. I think it's even called the Texas two-step, but I have yet to do that ever in my life. So I think she's probably much better at that than I am. I mean, I think realistically, it's not only footwork, it's arm work for the spinnaker up and downs as well for the crews here. You saw her. It's neat to see them actually be able to do that from the side of the boat. So you saw her with the harness out on the trapeze continuing to pull up the spinnaker after having just gone in and grabbed it. So it's a lot of calories burned for the crews, and we were kind of making a joke earlier with the 49er men about how big the breakfast was for Iago and how small the breakfast was for the skipper Diego, who were winning the men's fleet. But realistically, that's probably the way it is across all of the fleets, the crews burning more calories and needing to ingest and just make sure that they maintain their weight and most importantly maintain their muscle mass throughout a week like that. And we've spoken a bit with the teams as well about how long a week this feels like it's been. The 7 days seems just that one extra day is that tiny bit longer. And I think mentally it's draining as well to have the different variations of different breeze strengths every day. It's a really good test of skill. But as we're seeing here in the NACRA fleet in particular, the test of skill goes all the way through the fleet because we've got guys at the moment who are up at the top who haven't been and guys who are down deep who should be near the top. And maybe we're going to see some of that mental fatigue. Not even today as much as perhaps tomorrow and Sunday, having to keep it all together and physically and mentally, that's not easy.
Yeah, absolutely. And I think really interesting here, if you look in the background, the boat on the far side leading out, we saw him in the back of the picture, was Ruggiero, Tito and Carolina Banti. So they maybe heard you, Andy, and they've split tacks at the bottom. They've chosen not to follow the French and the Australian here. They've chosen to get themselves the space early on in the leg and let's see if that opportunity to stretch their legs is enough to get them past the French team here who took that right turn. They've sailed themselves out towards the left again and are using their powerful position of being ahead to make sure they can do what they want.
Interesting that the French aren't making the covering move. They're looking over their shoulder, they're thinking about what their closest rivals are doing, but they are allowing the Australians in second, the Italians, to gain leverage on them on the far side of the course. So they must have a lot of faith in going further in towards the lucky left here. And as they stretch their legs there, maybe they're being rewarded for taking that risk, because it looks like the breeze is getting a little bit stronger the further they go into the left-hand side.
Yeah, and I just think, again, these fast boats, shifty conditions, if you spend too much time looking back, then you're going to be really losing distance. You've got to sail your compass, get your head out and see what's coming to you. And sometimes what's coming to you isn't the perfect gust they've done on the other side of the course, but that doesn't mean I'm going to chase off to the other side of the course, because by the time you get to the other side of the course, it won't be there. So you've got to be patient. You've got to trust yourself, especially when you're towards the front of the fleet here. You've got to trust yourself. And unfortunately for them at the moment, they're looking a bit light. You can see they've kind of found themselves sat on a banana skin. And the Australian team, and in fact in the background, the Italian team have a bit more wind. But at the moment, the big winner looks like the Australian team. So clearly it's very patchy and you've got to get your head out of the boat and keep yourself going as fast as you can. But sometimes, you know, you don't get the roll of the dice your way.
So it looks like finally the left has run out of luck. This is the first time that we've seen someone lose that badly on the left-hand side of the course. And strangely, the Aussies must be in the same bit of wind as the French, but the French only now are just beginning to accelerate. So that was a nasty hole that they fell into there.
Yeah, hugely patchy. And now, so this is the Australians, 1, 2. This is their third tack on this upwind leg, because they did follow the French around the mark. So the wind is dropped, so my guess is it has got more puffy. You can see in the background there the Italians of Ruggiero. He looks like he's got a very nice right hand shift, and he's actually going to cross ahead of the French team as well. So there's been a reasonable change up on this leg. The wind has dropped, it has got gusty, so it is trying to keep as fast as we can.
Well, I like seeing the Aussie team do well here. I think We know online we're being followed by the Aussies we were speaking about earlier, Jason Waterhouse and Lisa Dominan, not able to be here because of Jason's injury recently, but good to see their fellow, I think fellow cousins, the two of them are cousins, they're medalists in Rio, and then we're just talking about Paul Dominan here in second, I believe, cousin of Lisa as well, if not of Jason also, so... Hi guys, thanks for following. Sad we don't have you here.
With Jason online.
Yeah.
Oh, it'd be very nice to hear from Jason if his back injury is anything to do with Tom Slingsby smelling something coming out of the bakery shop in San Francisco.
I don't think that was a shift that Tommy smelled there. That just a bearing away, try to make the finish line. But the reality is I'm sure that they're missing sailing here. And I think it's great to see both Aussie teams here, actually. In fact, as you look at the tracker at the moment, the Outerage siblings out to the right have moved well up through this. They were rounding the top mark fifth originally on the first upwind. We haven't seen them necessarily have the best regatta here. We know Nath has a young son, Jack, at home, so he's been a bit busy and has probably less training time than he wants. But to see them moving up through at least from fifth, it looks like they're about fourth at the moment. But it is going to be a really tight battle for that country to decide who... Sorry, Jason and Lisa, we'll be talking about you guys while you're not racing, but to decide who's going to go to Tokyo 2020.
Yeah, I mean, if you're a selector, you're probably both nervous and smiling in that it's what a fantastic opportunity to have either of those teams. I think, you know, Jason and Lisa have proved themselves to be, you know, the top team, and it's going to be a big challenge for Nathan and Haley, but for certainly us not involved, it's going to be great to watch. It's great to see Nathan coming up towards the front of the fleet here. I know he's struggled with the conditions we've had this week, getting the boat downwind quickly in the big wave, and he'll be enjoying being inside Portland Harbour where it's a bit flatter and probably a bit more what they're used to in Sydney Harbour.
That's probably right, but at the same time, he's learned an awful lot by being out in the big waves. I mean, he was very, very open about the fact that he really didn't know what he was doing out there in the big waves a couple of days ago. And whilst it would have hurt on the day, Nathan is all about learning as much as he can as quickly as possible. So that was a massive learning curve that he was going through the other day. The only thing is, you'd rather be doing that learning during training, not during the middle of the European Championships.
Yeah, absolutely. But I suppose you take what you get, don't you?
And he's running so short on time. I mean, you say it's a close battle for selection in Australia. I'd say the only thing that makes them be taken as seriously as they are is the fact that he's won two Olympic medals. He is Nathan Outeridge. He's got a huge amount of experience sailing in the America's Cup in foiling boats. I think if it was anyone else, that such a late running campaign wouldn't be taken as seriously as that.
But look at this. Here we go. Current world champions there, the Italians. Just crossing, tacking ahead, and we can see the wind has gone a bit strange because that dogleg, that spacer mark at the top's really quite an upwind angle still, which is obviously a little bit unusual. But you can see the world champions, Andy called it. It's not been quite as easy as you made it out.
I thought
to
I put
be,
the commentator's curse on them.
Well, I thought we assumed your magic touch would have done that as well, Andy, but it looks like you've called it pretty good. And it was the split of the bottom mark. They've got themselves the space. But you can see how shifty it is. It's still really tight with these top three boats. It'll be interesting. It's a decent gap for the Italians now. They're away. And from what we've seen on the downwind legs before, the teams have been keeping it pretty simple. So can you get round in a bit of breeze, get the boat smooth? And I think from over the last 12 months, there has been no team that's smoother than this team. So now they're in front, clear air. They're the ones getting to lead the decisions. And would expect to see them, you know, be quite smooth. Interesting, actually, that the helm and the crew are moving there. So maybe a better contender for Strictly Come Dancing in that they've got the both of them working well together.
Sharing the work. But interesting that Ruggiero is the male. He's the helm. He's a bigger proportion of the weight. Whereas with the Danes that we saw winning the previous race, it was Lynn Senholt at the back, the smaller helm. And so leaving it to her crew... the larger CP Lubeck to do all the gunwale running all by himself.
Yeah, absolutely, and that'll be, you know, your different techniques and what works for you. But it's a bit less wind, so the guys are having to foil the boat a little bit flatter. There's not that same inclination to have the bow down where you kind of, I guess, feel like you've got plenty of lift. They're obviously working hard to keep the boat up on the foil, and that's why we can see the boats are flatter and not foiling quite as high and bow down as they were in the first race where they were ripping around a bit more. But I think this race will be, we talked a little bit before about the good guys perhaps having to learn the course for the day and understand what the conditions are doing, and they don't just have magic answers. They're very good at executing when they know it, and now we're seeing the world champion, the I suppose, really the favourites, certainly the dominant team for the last 12 months. Not had a great first race. I guess they've had a bit of a chat with each other, a bit of a chat with their coach, and worked out a little bit more what's going on with the day. And here they go. They're up and running, out in the lead, and potentially getting the wheels back on their wagon.
Let's see how they go through this jibe. Can they keep it on the foils? Not quite. But actually, they're quite slow getting back up to speed again. But everyone else is going to have to do that same jibe. So they've given away distance during the jibe, but the French are going to need to make that same manoeuvre fairly shortly. Let's see how their jibe compares.
I think it's really quite light wind out there, Ricey. You can see the boats dropping down. The trouble with going that fast is to reload is a massive luff up like you saw the French do there.
Exactly. You can see such a huge angle change between foiling downwind and not, and that's probably 30 degrees there. So at the moment, they're foiling downwind. And realistically, do we know what that cutoff even would be between when they're maybe not foiling downwind? Is it almost below the race limit? So if it's 5 knots, they're not foiling, they're actually not racing anyway. So realistically, that the amount of time that it takes you to get back on the foils and the distance that you have to be sailing away from the marks is just the as much as you can minimize that, the better you are.
Yeah, and that's where the hours of practice come in, and maybe if we have got some fairly knowledgeable friends online, they could be good enough to text us, to message us the answer to what sort of wind speed. But there's not a huge amount of wind out there now. Certainly I would guess 7-8 knots, they'd still be hoping to be up on the foils. But I think you saw how much those manoeuvres cost. So here you see the two red spinnakers to the top of the screen, two Australian boats. Now they've both jibed early, perhaps hoping for a shift, but they're going to end up with an extra manoeuvre. And suddenly when it gets lighter like this, that payoff of doing extra manoeuvres is costly.
Well, I think right at the finish line is about the right spot to do that extra manoeuvre. So very well sailed for the Italians, Ruggero Tita and Caterina Banti. We've said earlier when they had rough races that we weren't expecting it, and yet the rough races weren't even that rough if it was anyone else. So well done to that team for showing why they're so often at the front of this leaderboard. Behind them, the French trying to hold on until the very end, but a reason why they were sitting 20th going into today, Moana and Noah, and yet to be able to take a second place here. An amazing race, and still a very close finish here for third. I think realistically, whoever pulls off a better jibe here, yeah, because that's not, sorry, this orange flag here is not the finish line, but or
so,
no,
so
it
that's
is the
dominant.
Finish line boat. It
dominant
is, yeah,
have so, got third.
So well done there for the Australians, just crossing across ahead of both the Brits behind them and the blue spinnaker on the far side. Hard to see who it is here, but I think it's the other Australians, the Outeridge siblings. So that is a tight battle, and the outer just trying to get a little extra speed right at the end to see if, but I think probably that's going to be Brits.
I wouldn't want to call that.
I'm going to say Saxon and Boniface got that. I think they just nipped in ahead of Outeridge then.
Yeah.
I would agree with that. All right, so then we've got, that's top five. Sixth was the Italians there, the second Italian team, Ugolini just crossing through. Seventh, the Austrians there, Argentinian and GBR 25 crossing the line. I think Argentina far side there. Red spinnaker, but again, these are not accurate results. These are
just
us calling question marks. Yeah.
So hard to tell, and the speed they're finishing.
There are some other big names that we should be seeing by now, aren't there? We're not seeing them yet. That is Delapierre and Odenet from France, but what about more famous French like Besson and Rieu, the four-time world champions? What about those Danes, Senholt and Lubeck, who won the previous race? What about John Gimpson and Anna Burnett, our overnight leaders? Where are those sailors? So things are going to shake up again on this leaderboard, and this Portland Harbour racecourse is really turning out to be Mario Kart. I still don't know what that is, because...
Do you not know Mario Kart?
No,
right.
Because that was 80s, and I was already an old man by the 80s.
Well, it's just, you know, we're just trying to freshen things up a bit, Andy, from Snakes and Ladders.
Right, but we've got a French team here and a Spanish team coming down, so this perhaps could be Billy Besson and Marie Rieu. I believe it is, yeah, France 99, looking on the tracker. The Spanish team, again, could possibly... Oh, no, it's German, sorry, not Spain. But, yeah, that's the French through the line. That's the Germans through the line, and then either Kiwis here or second Australian team, looks like... Oh, no, Gimpson Burnett.
It looks like an Australian.
So Gimpson Burnett in around the mid-teens in this race.
13, 14.
Yeah.
Not great for them.
No, it's a tough day. I mean, I think this is pretty good camera angle. You can look upwind and you can see the kind of texture to the water that the guys are having to work with. If you look for the darker bits, the lighter bits, that's all opportunity for for good things and bad things, I suppose, would be the way of looking at it.
You just don't want to say snakes and ladders, do you, Stevie?
No, desperately not. But, no. but you know, it's a tricky race course, and it's a very, very different race course to what we've seen for the other day. And we've seen the big names. It's very up and down, but it's a short course. You see how small the harbour is, really. Well, it doesn't feel small in most boats, but in these boats, it's small. This is a small race course. And things are happening very, very quickly. Your decisions are taken away from you very, very fast. And yeah, I mean, it's great. I think it's a real spice up on the leaderboard. Yeah, and that's what you want. Like Jenny said, it's a full test.
I think not only are your decisions taken away from you quickly, but the positions are taken away quickly as well. I think realistically, having seen the Brits and the current leaders finishing there just in 13th and 14th, I think we'll see another shakeup at the moment, and I think we'll probably see that first place then allowing Ruggiero Tita and Caterina Banti to jump to first place overall from what was third going into that race. So it has been a tricky day on the water. There are already some deep scores here for the NACRA fleet. We've said there's only the one throw out for everyone. So with one more race to go still, it's going to be a hefty day for some of the teams.
It's full on, and again for Lynn and CP Lubeck, they're going to fall back on their third. Was their discard currently. So that race won't have short-term ramifications for them. They'll still be, still probably be first by one point or two.
Yeah.
But yeah, they've now got a 13th in their pocket, which is similar to the Italians. So that, you know, that's sat over them now, but it shows you how consistency is the key. And what we're also seeing is actually how being consistent is really, really not very easy. So it's compared to yesterday, where I think you could be a little bit more precise. Today, you've got to kind of take on and sail the wind that you can see and actually make some decisions yourself rather than basing it on percentage sailing around the fleet. And that's the whole fleet finished there. Some reasonably big gaps in the fleet there, I guess, because it's a bit shifty.
And just talking about consistency, just going out left of picture, that Union Jack was GBR 88, Chris Rashley and Laura Merriman, Giovanetti. They were vying for the lead in the previous race, and they were almost last in that race, not ticking the consistency box.
No. I can safely say they've ignored the consistency box, but it shows you how hard and how tough this racing is when a guy like Chris Rashley, who's was a leading light in the Moth fleet for a very long time, a really, really high level sailor, and you can have some bad races. But what we've seen that with all of them, and the nature of these fast boat sailing is you need to put a bit of Teflon on your shoulders and let that race wash away. And probably for John Gimpson and Anna Burnett, this next race, I'd say, is really, really crucial. The Danes and the Italians have both had a good one and a bad one, but it's that kind of day.
No one's going to own the day, are they? I don't think we're going to see anyone own today.
Just looking through the other fleets as well, the 49er men and women racing out there, it's the same across all the fleets. It is a difficult task to be racing out there at the moment. We probably knew it going into today, you know, when the weather's tricky like this, when the venue's going to be having a northerly, which means breeze from the shore, you kind of go out knowing no one's going to nail this with three bullets on the day, which has happened with some of the fleets in previous days outside breezier conditions. So I think legitimately seeing the scores like this is probably what we should have expected. But then when it happens, you're just like, oh, wow, this is interesting. Hello, these are new faces. And some of the faces we're expecting to see up there aren't there. And I think it's unique to see, but also to kind of expect in a way. However, it does mean that the scores are going to get a lot more interesting. I mean, we're seeing on the NACRA fleet in particular, everyone up and down. But looking just quickly at the men's fleet, no one in the top five really had actually gotten the top five in that first race that they raced. The guys who did well, James Peters and Finn Sterrett with the second, were sitting fifth overall. So, and I think they were sixth going into the day. And the women's was a bit the same. The girls who did well in the women's fleet were much deeper. The first and second were sitting 13th and 17th overall. So tricky conditions out there. And probably to Stevie's point, it's not about winning the race. It's about doing well in the regatta. And if you're someone who's doing well in the regatta in general, you're going to be playing it a bit more conservative in these races, and perhaps that's what we're seeing But I don't know if Gimson and Anna are, if that's playing it conservative, it's not going to be the right move for keeping them on the leaderboard. As you're saying, the next race is a make or break for them.
Yeah, I think so. No, I mean, I don't know. We always used to have a bit of a checklist. I don't know whether it's true or not, but I heard a rumor that in his wallet, Russell Coutts used to have a card, five sets of cards. And this is when he sailed his fin dinghy. I imagine for an America's Cup boat, you need a bloody briefcase. But on he had a thing. And so when the conditions changed and you were walking down or you were waking up in the morning and you saw it's 7 knots, flat water, you look on your card and you just remember your key points. What are the key points on racing a day like today? Good lay lines, flatter sails, clear starts, give myself, you know, sail the lifted tack. Just very, very basic points. But today is a completely different day to yesterday. Completely different skill set. It's not a different sport, but in some ways it's a very, very different sport. You know, they are going from being a slightly longer distance runner to more of a sprint runner today. It's a short course. You need to attack. You need to be a little bit more aggressive, a little bit more punchy. Yeah, you're trying to be consistent, but you've got to take it on. You haven't got the time for patience to play out. You've got to be relatively patient when you need to be patient, but at the same time, you've got to be ready to attack it. And I wonder, if I was in the coach boat with John and Anna now, maybe just to sit them down. I know they've worked a lot with Ian Percy, and it'd be great if Ian's watching right now, but I imagine Ian would love to be out on that rib now and just be able to punch into them a couple of basic points, you know, and just simplify it, because there's probably a lot of noise in their head at the moment, and you'll know the results. As much as you're trying to look forward, you'll be well aware of what's happened in the past, but they need to see the simple things and trust the fact they're fast, they're good racers, and they can get
going. Let's do it. What would the points be? I mean, I think point number one.
Port Tech Star.
Port Tech Star. I was going to say, we heard it from Helen yesterday, and they actually they'd just done, looking at the women's fleet, they had actually just done well in that first race. But their point yesterday, and you were saying, was start line. You know, and that is actually kind of the point that matters no matter what, except maybe in Breeze. In Breeze, you don't have to have the best start in the world, because if you're fast, you can still get up there. But in yesterday's conditions and today's conditions, it's get off the start. And we haven't been speaking about, and I'm sorry, I keep hammering on them. I hope you guys don't watch this back, John and Anna, because we've given them a hard time this morning, but we haven't seen them off the start yet. So realistically, if someone's out there coaching them, they're probably saying,
let's just
get a line.
Yeah.
Get off the start line, you know? And I think we've seen the Germans, with the Port Tech start, they should have maybe been able to win that race had they just tacked back and protected earlier, and they got perhaps a little greedy, which might happen when you're sitting there. They were sitting 25th going into today.
And also, I imagine their heart rate went through the roof for that whole period going across on Port Tack, thinking, are we going to make it? Are we not? And
they're probably on the defibrillator for a couple of minutes afterwards.
Yeah. Decision making goes a bit out the window.
That age range that he needs the defibrillator.
All right. That's just me then.
but that's point one, no matter what yesterday and today, is start line. But then what would the other say if we've just got four? What would the other three be today that maybe you think are different from yesterday's, if you know going into this? Is it shifts because of the northerly? Is it keeping your eyes out of the boat a bit more?
I think my first thing would be, let's go back and double check the setup. We saw after that first race, so many boats were changing their sail setting. Now, if you want to race well, the boat needs to feel good. And it needs to feel like I can look outside the boat. If it's all changed from yesterday, chances are the setup of the boat isn't quite feeling as we'd like it to. So I think let's go and double check in with the numbers, whether that's a bottle screw. I've not seen it. A 49er is a bottle screw and shroud pins that you needed to check that was there. And my setting's good. I've got a tuning guide for that. And then, can I get my head out and just trust what I see? Try and sail with a bit of freedom. It's hard when you've got the yellow bib on and you've got that pressure, you've got that expectation. You're a little bit marked. I mean, when I walked in the dinghy park this morning and I bumped into a guy with a hood on, it was Pete Burling walking through, and so we were chatting a little bit. And, you know, they're well aware that if they're doing okay in a race but not great, people, if they're unsure where to tack, will tack on their line. Because it's like, we'll probably want to be going this way because Pete and Blair want to go there. Bang! Pete and Blair can't go that way anymore. Yeah. You are a bit more marked. And if you've got the yellow bib on, you're probably a little bit more marked. So let's have a good start.
You used to be that Pied Piper, didn't you? Did you find that wherever you went, the rest of the fleet followed as well, because you were the...
We always managed to confuse them too much by making them think we were a bit stupid. We did a pretty good job of being fairly stupid in the dinghy battle race, that everyone just assumed it was blind luck. So no, I don't know. I mean, you have your battles, but I think it, for John and Anna now, it's a reset. They're more than good enough to win the race. They've shown that all week. So let's get our head out. They've got to trust what they see. And that's not easy after a couple of bad races, to trust your decisions. But go back, check the settings, check the handling technique things. And yeah, it is. It's a puff and patch day. It's a day where you've got to see the dark bits on the water and link as many of those together without going into the big holes like we saw the French team go into. Again, very, very, very easy to say that sat here. But a pivotal race for them in the regatta, because if they can turn it around now, I think that shows show huge strength and fortitude going forward. Which you know, to be fair for the Italians, they've done a great job of that in the last race.
Turning around, yeah, they were third maybe at the top mark, but they were sitting quite deep at points in the first upwind, and I think we know that they're fast. Realistically, they're not a team that has to worry about their speed. They're just a team who needs to kind of maybe stay out of the corners and in the middle a little and stay out of the protest room as well, I think, some of the other teams. So
they paid a high price in the first race by being one of the most far right boats out by the Portland Harbour wall, as were John Gimpson and Anna Burnett, and neither of those teams managed to get back into the race in race one. So it was interesting to see the Italians come in from the left hand side, which was quite a busy place to be on that first beat, wasn't it? And probably rightly so, because the left at the top seems to be quite strong.
Yeah.
That we, because of our camera positions, we've seen a lot more of the left than the right, but I haven't had a chance to look back through. But did the outrages make a big gain on the right on the final beat?
We've also seen the Germans gain on the right on the first upwind of that race. We saw them split to the right and come back in into second. Sorry, was that even the first race? Maybe I'm getting them twisted in my mind, but we've seen the right play in the first race. And we've seen it again with the outrages, kind of middle right on the second upwind of that one. So I think some of that, I think realistically some of that might be traffic of the spinnakers coming downwind. The further that they've set and gone into that left corner, the further that they're coming along that ley line. And so you end up, if you round the left-hand mark and you're going this way, you're sailing through all that spinnaker.
Mm.
Crud.
So a short hitch out to the right.
The short right hitch just gives you clear breathing room, and with the lighter breeze today, I think it matters. We really particularly saw when we were on board with the Austrians during that race how light it was for them in that left corner for a long period of time before they were then stretching their legs and getting back into racing, and that was probably 20 boat lengths of them kind of being full knees bent for a period of time. And if someone had rounded the right mark and gone straight legs right away, then you can't beat a shift at the top with bad air at the bottom.
Yeah, and you've got to play what's in front of you, and the race does evolve as you go through it. There's different situations you've got to take on as that race evolves. But I think later on in the race there's more space because the boats are a bit further apart, and you can perhaps look around and pick those patches earlier on in the race. You don't want to get yourself too much out to the corners, but if I wanted to be anywhere, I'd like to be hedging my way towards the left a little bit, and just trying to make sure I am not too extreme. But that boils down to, can I get a start where I can hold a lane and I can make the first decision?
Mm.
Bet if we asked any of the guys that have had a bad race today, they'll say, I just got bounced, which means, you know, I've just been forced to go where I didn't choose to go.
Yeah.
So that's
which has got to hurt in a boat like an Acro, where a manoeuvre is so expensive. In a laser, if you get bounced, it's not really going to hurt you that much.
No, you just do your two tacks and then sit out again until your eyes bleed and come winging it in. Whereas in these things happen so quickly and yeah, like you say, it's so expensive doing the extra manoeuvres.
Yeah, and the lighter sometimes in the laser, the tacks are less expensive or even better than they are going straight in a way.
Oh, that's contentious, isn't it? Rule 42 territory, which fortunately...
And luckily then they usually end up cancelling the races when it gets to the point where you see people are just going forward by attacking. It's like,
I've seen quite a few regattas run where that hasn't happened in the last year. I mean, when you've got to get races in, I've seen races get in what you would consider to be unraceable conditions. Mm. The thing that amazes me is that sailors almost never complain about it. They just take what they're given, and where most of us weekend club sailors would be saying, well, I'm not going out in that, they just suck it up. The Olympic sailors just go out and they make the best of it, even when it's a lottery. Can't afford to think negative thoughts. That seems to be it. And I remember for the 2008 games in Beijing, which is always expected to be light, I always asked Nick Rogers and Joe Glanfield in the 470, how do you even cope with knowing that you've got to go out in those kind of conditions? And Nick would always say, light and lovely, Andy, light and lovely. And it's just a mindset shift.
I mean, it is a different, it's two totally different mindsets. There's the having to go out in light air, which maybe you don't like, and then there's the like teeth knuckly days in Palma where the waves are just massive and you have to get out through the beach break, and it's, you're going, how much money am I going to have to spend today on everything that I've broken by the time I come in? And that's, you know, and which one's worse when you're on shore? You don't necessarily know. The light air days when you're mentally trying to get yourself ready, and the breezy days where you're physically like, how are my ankles doing today? And can I flex them a bit more to make sure that they're going okay later on in the day? And I think realistically, that is the life of Olympic sailors, is having to go the whole breadth of the in-between and keep the middle as well today sort of racing. And that's what's just so spectacular about watching it and racing it ourselves as well, but watching it here and just thinking about what they've gone through and what they... You can see the orange flag up now, so we're inside of 5 minutes to go for the third race of the day for the Nacras here. We are constantly trying to check to see if we can get scores and updates for you guys on the 49er and the FX fleets. We haven't heard answers of a second race of them yet. So I think at the moment it is still Nacras going into race three, and probably the other two have completed, but we don't quite have updates there. But
results coming up for 30 seconds.
But we will see them very shortly, at least for the Nacra fleet. Here are our most recent results. So as you were saying, Stevie, still leading at the top of the leaderboard, Lynn and CP. Moving into second there, Ruggiera and Katarina, very close tight battle with those two with just 2 points, and then 11 points back. Gimson and Burmett with a 15. I thought I saw them at 11th or 13th at points in that race, but dropping to 15th for the finish line. And then a good day so far for the Argentinians. They moved up from 5th this morning to 4th, and a 4 and an 8, I think, in these conditions, that's the best we've seen of the top five, in fact. So.
Yeah, I mean, if you look down the list there, to get two single digit results is very, very hard. So it just shows what kind of day it is, where you've just got to keep scrapping and fighting. And like you say, we did see John and Anna up at around 11th, 12th. But the reality is, very, very quickly, things can turn around if you're in that pack, Andy. I mean, it is, as I say, we talked with Ruggiero and Katrina about the fact that they're kind of used to winning. I guess they're used to being at the front of a fleet and making those small decisions with, for a first or a second. But when you're coming 10th and there's 20 metres to 5th and 20 metres to 18th, everything can change real fast, and it's a fight. And John and Anna have found themselves in that fight, as of the Danes, as of the Italians, as of everyone, to be perfectly honest. And looking down that list, the Argentinians, Matteo and Eugenia, Ben Saxton and Nicky, and then down in 10th, Thomas and Barbara, the Austrian NACRA team. They're the only ones with single-digit scores, so it shows you just how hard it is out there, basically. And this last race will be no different. You can see in the background here, the fleet's already lined up. I'm not entirely sure how long there is to go until the start here. But the U-flag's still up, so that means we've got more than a minute to go. Oh, you go, 1 minute. There you go, called it. And the guys are all lined up in position. More of an even spread of the fleet down the line, so I don't anticipate seeing a full cowboy manoeuvre by our German friends this time. But you can see there, GBR 88, that's Chris Rashley. GBR 21, which of course is John Gibson, he's got himself down this way on the line. I like that. He's got himself in a nice position, a bit more down the line. At the moment, he's got a little bit of a gap, but hopefully we'll see him be able to hold a good start. The fleet's looking quite well mannered at the moment. Not sure if they're going to start pushing forward, but we're only under U flag, so of course that means that if it is a general recall, then anyone that is over will be safe. I learned that one yesterday, and that's good to know. But yeah, you can see the fleet lined up. It's now a case of time and distance and judging that acceleration, which in this light winds won't be easy.
Got 7 seconds to go. It's interesting to see three British flags lined up here at the bottom end of the line. So impressive. They've just gone, it's on. We're Brits. We know these waters. We want the left. The left's been paying. And I think realistically, we've talked about the right working on the second upwind, but it does always seem like the left has worked on the first upwind, and really well done here on a decent clean start, I think, across the board. And if that's Gimson and Burnett, the boat off the pin there, that actually looks to be, GBR 88 off the pin.
Chris Rashley.
To be firing again.
Our boat from Ben Saxton won the pin in race one earlier. And if you remember, Ben Saxton didn't have such a good start in race one and was the wrong side of Chris Rashley's mainsail. But this time a much better start for Ben Saxton and Nicky Boniface. So good starts for the two British teams coming off the pin end of the line here.
Yeah, noticeably, like you say, the three British flags down here a bit more aggressive, and I guess, you know, the coaches perhaps called that. Let's have a bit of an attack there. Unfortunately, is that John Gimson tacking out?
Exactly. It looks like the third British flag is the first there onto port tack. So Gimson and Anna, we said they need to get off the start line, and they have not necessarily done so. So tacking over onto port, forced out to that right-hand side, I think, is going to be another unfortunate position. Whether or not they can climb back through later on, we'll have to see. But really great boat speed here for Rashley, just really working to weather. All right, and Saxton and Bonifetch going for the tack and the cross here, and it looks like they're pulling it off as well.
Yeah, I mean, that's good knowledge of what your boat will do. I mean, that to me, that looked like it was going to be tight, but it was a very comfy cross. I remember Ian Walker and Johnny Merricks. I got to sail with them in the day, and their one big thing for them was if you can cross. So they've had a good start, and let's put a time to bag those boats. But again, we saw before the Germans crossed when he could cross, but we need to at some times come back. So my guess is we're going to see Chris Rashley be pretty brave, come all the way left here. Ben's going to cross as many boats as he can, and I'd be surprised if we didn't see Saxton and Boniface tack back before getting too far out that way, because we can see they're already going behind some boats in the background there, which long term won't be great. But there's the Greek team tacking. Sophia, she liked the left before. Rashley, he's like the left, and he's tacking here. Now, can he get a decent gust of wind to get accelerated?
You know, I would say that wasn't the best tack either. I think really when we saw Ben tack earlier, he swung it through very hard, super aggressively, and they crossed, you know, and I thought at the time, wow, that was a really fast turn in that tack, and actually it seemed to do what they wanted, and that one I think was a much slower turn and probably not actually what they needed there. They needed to just be spinning it through and getting accelerating on the other side.
Yeah, and he was, you know, I think that's maybe an experience in the boat. Of course, Ben Saxton's been around the NACRA class for a long time. He's a past world champion, and he's been several times medalist at the world champion, so very experienced in these boats. And also, I think there was an element, Ben was leading that decision. He was very positive to tack, probably felt he was in a good gust. Chris was kind of clearly waiting for the Greek boat to go, and then it's, okay, I should try and cross the fleet now because I'm in a strong place, but perhaps wasn't making his own call to tack. He was, despite being in the box seat at that stage, he was maybe being a little reactive to the Greek and therefore not doing the perfect tack.
I think they're sailing quite sensibly in that I don't think they have full confidence in their boat speed, GBR 88. So they're making the best of what they got. They're not putting themselves under too much pressure by trying to sail in thin lanes or tack in thin spaces like Ben Saxton is able to do. So I think to some extent Chris Rashley knows that he has to sail within his means.
I think in some ways as well, it's to your point, they had a fifth in the first race after a great start in the left-hand side. But they've just had a 27th, which is second last in this fleet. So if you had confidence from race one, you maybe lost it in race two. So then to kind of go, let's reset and do what we did in race one, that worked out well. Well, they've done that. They nailed the pin in. They went out to the left side. But yeah, that confidence might be lacking anyways because they're not as good in general in the NACRAs. They're not as top up of the fleet anyway. So we weren't seeing them. We saw them doing well and kind of climbing to weather, but we weren't really seeing them make their own decisions. They were being dictated a little bit, and to make the decision that way, it makes sense. You'd almost love to just go, oh yeah, they've just, I would have loved to see them be the one that did the first tack and cross the fleet, yeah, and not have Ben and Nicola do that. But yeah, realistically, I think it's hard to come back from second last to do it again, because it's not a day where they'd had a capsize or anything. It was just they must have had a bad race last race.
Well, it was a high-risk move what Saxton did, and he got away with it, so we're calling him a genius. But if he hadn't have done that, we'd have said, well, what a silly billy, why did he do that? it could have ended up really badly, especially if Chris Rashley did the tack that he did in the position that Saxton was, if you know what I mean.
I probably wouldn't have said silly billy, so no, I'm not sure I know what you mean, but no, I'm just kidding.
It's a bit older than that, aren't
you? And maybe pretty skinned in fact now, I'm sorry.
Yeah, we've got a broad demographic watching this video at the moment, so, you know, I call it a video, you call it a live feed or something.
Absolutely. But we see the fleet here now spread out, a lot of boats on port tack. And we split to the tracker here, we can see that actually, is that 91, is that Saxton?
That is still.
Yeah, so Ben Saxton and Nathan Outeridge as well, both of them, they've cut right across that middle. We saw that a little bit yesterday. They've got themselves left in general on the course. Now, of course, they're towards the right, but that's the end of the beat. So they're clearer boats, and Ben Saxton's clearly chosen a fantastic point to tack out. And Nathan Outeridge. So we obviously had a very big left shift up that beat when Saxton chose to tack. He's got out, stuck the cross in when he can, and potentially himself and Nathan are going to be in a good position at the top mark. But this top left has still got a big group coming in very fast.
Yeah, it does sort of look like Nathan and Haley got the righty sooner than Ben and Nicola did there. You saw them going in the lefty, and then there's about a 5-10 degree angle right in their track. So interesting, they've just continued on the header to what must be the ley line here. And yeah, you can see the Brits in front of them tacking sort of on their line on the ley line. But that's such a hard call when you know the left might be coming through and might be favored and there's a left shift up top, to actually keep going in that header and the righty to the right side. And perhaps that's, yeah, not help them stay in second, I think, as we see the Italians come across here in front of the Australians. Perhaps the Italians coming across in the lead again, it looks like. They're easily in the lead here from the Brits and from the right-hand side.
Yeah, certainly just watching that tracker before we came to this live shot, it felt like the wind was filling in on this top left, and Ruggiero's, you know, he's no muppet, is he? He's seen that after the first race, and he's executed it pretty well. And if you're fast and you use your brain like he has done, he's, you know, done a fantastic job here. Nice, smooth tack. Good rhythm on the boat. They're used to being in first, so they're not super excited and anything else. So that's a normal, very, very good, very smooth tack, well executed. And, you know, guys like Ben Saxton and Nathan, if he, you know, we're trying to get to the top mark, top seven and eight, and work from there on a day like today. You don't want to be getting there 20 or something like that. And a lot of this has stemmed from just having a solid start, being able to hold it out to the left-hand side, which is what Ben Saxton did, got a good crossing. The Argentinians and the Italians were all coming out this way. I didn't exactly see where Ruggiero was, but he's, you know, we know he's quick, and he was coming in on this top left-hand side. So he's done the basics well. Great rounding from Ben Saxton there.
Amazing how early they're getting onto these Jennikers. I almost wondered if it was a little bit too soon and it puts them under pressure before they've done the bear away, but it seems like the way that it works in these marginal conditions.
Yeah, I think you just want to get it on pretty soon. And in fact, look there, GBR 21 just coming into the mark. So that's much better from...
I think that's 25.
There's 21 just behind him.
Oh, sorry, okay.
It's all right, it's your old eyes rising. Don't worry, mate. But is Gibson coming round the mark there. And that's a little better mark rounding for him now. Good chance to use his speed. Got the yellow vest there. And up they go, straight up on the foils. And can we start to make some way through? But you can just see how now it's so tight in the pack, Jenny.
Yeah, it's beautiful. I mean, I think really it's been so tight all day with the Necro fleet. We've seen guys from like 25th to 14th to back into 18th and then back into 7th. And we haven't actually spent that much time focusing on this middle part of the pack and the movements there. But when you look at the tracker, it is up and down and all over the place. And the second upwind is where we then sort of start to see it spread out a little. And we sort of start to see people get ingrained in their positions a bit. But lots of Germans and lots of French flags at the moment, so not the best positioning for those two countries, because I think now we're looking at kind of the deep 20s. That's Johannes Polgar rounding in 19th, and the French team, who was up at the top second last race, rounding just there in 18th. So difficult ask, but really a huge, huge extension here for Italy 26.
Not
and unfortunately for the who looked like they were doing well for a second there, the Outeridge siblings dropping into 7th. So Denmark, finally 71. They were 14th last race, so having won the first race and having been sitting kind of in first and still sitting in first, this is probably good for them. You'll keep the six as a keeper.
Yeah,
for
absolutely.
Sure.
And they've got plenty of race left to play with here. It looks like we might have lost Ben Saxton's tracker as he was second in behind Ruggiero. and Carolina. So it's you can see this side of the course has been a big left shift. They're all coming really well down here, really limiting the opportunities that you've got on the course, which is great if you're in the lead, and a little bit frustrating if you're not. But what it will do is make the decision at the leeward gate not easy, okay? Because Ruggiero, everything we've seen says do a right turn and come back this way. Doing a right turn and coming back this way puts you straight through the entirety of the fleet at the moment.
It's not worth it, is it? Surely you want to do that short hitch out towards the harbour wall and then put a tap back.
Quite probably. Yeah, I mean, it certainly makes sense. I mean, you can't see what's there wind-wise and all the rest of it, but being able to be at speed, I would be pretty concerned, especially if I was Ruggiero. He's far enough ahead, he can just do the left turn, but as soon as the next boat's getting to the leeward mark, if they're going to go right turn, I tack, and I'm then straight up wind of them. And if they follow me, well, then I can take a look and look at the wind behind me. So the beauty of having a slight lead like he has just gives him that little bit of opportunity to play it safe. But I think you're quite right. But as soon as you're fifth, sixth, that's not going to be a very easy choice to make.
Exactly. I think in some ways he's almost got enough of a lead that when he rounds that bottom right to go out to the left-hand side of the course, he actually doesn't have to fight as much spinnaker traffic and bad air as guys who are sixth or seventh and are just that much closer and further to the rest of them coming down. And in fact, it does look like this is them coming out to the left. So they have rounded. They have gone that way. They have left the right side open a little bit and the door open there for someone to take, but no one has taken it yet. It does look like on the tracker, Argentina is heading that way. So we'll see the boat about fourth place, and you can see them just there rounding and heading that way as well. And also, it doesn't look like there's much breeze on either side. Argentina just bobbing around that right-hand mark, in fact.
It looked breezy up at the Wimber Mark, didn't it? I thought maybe the breeze was picking up at the Wimber Mark, and I thought maybe this is a new breeze, but it just looks like maybe there is just softer breeze at the bottom of the course.
Yeah, and generally speaking, the wind does die earlier down near here in the centre, and as you go up the course to the sea wall and then out to where the 49ers are racing, I'd expect them to have a little bit more wind for longer than we do. That's quite classic here. But, you know, again, this decision-making, we can't see the bias on the gate and everything like that. So there's many, many variables for making that decision. But Ruggiero and Carolina have decided, you know, we like the left-hand side of the course. It's done us proud in the first beat, so let's make sure we get back out there. And that's the beauty of being out there and actually being able to see what they can see on the water. But you can see a fairly busy racetrack, and that's not going to be helping the wind at the bottom of the course either.
Here we go. Here's the breeze that they kind of finally get into once they've left the bottom, once they've left the spinnaker bad air, fully trapezing again. You know, that's a solid minute and a half of us talking about how light it is down at the bottom before we actually see them get into that pressure that's up the course. So I think anything you can do to get quickly up and out in that direction would be a gain. For these guys, they're winning already, but for the guys more middle of the pack, fighting for the middle of the pack, that's what you're looking for. What can you be doing to get you to be looking like this and not knees in, bent in, inside?
Well, I think for the guys in the middle of the pack, that left turn's going to mean you get to pick your tack back onto starboard and head to the left. There isn't really anything you can do is the trouble of being back in there. You've got to not make a mistake by not forcing things. You've got to be a little bit patient out the leeward mark, have had a look, see where you see the breeze on the water, and then take your head up, keep the boat sailing well, realistically in a high mode, because that's going to give you options to tack, and try and find, is there a hole, is there a lane, we call it in sailing, call it a lane, that I can tack in that's going to have me clear and find this clear breeze. But the reality is, if you go around the leeward mark in 10th, you've made some mistakes earlier in the race that are going to compromise you. And if you're in the league like Ruggiero and Carolina here, then here we go, nice tack from them. Let's watch that.
So you can see the skipper even there does a little bit of a roll tack. He pulls really hard on his trapeze handle going into the tack. It's nice to see the crew still, it's light enough that they are still tacking forward of the mast. We saw way earlier this morning that it was just breezy enough for them to be tacking after the mast, but I think this is probably the most breeze we have. I think this is the most breeze we have seen in the last race and a half, really. We saw that this morning, but we haven't seen them fully extended like this in a while.
Yeah, Ben Saxton and Nicky down there, you know, they're well powered out on the wire, and I just thought that was just great watching that tack, how smoothly they moved across the bow. The hull came up really, really early on the exit of the tack, and they didn't dive on the trapeze. They were patient, smooth. They let the boat build speed. And obviously, you know, if you've got two hulls and you can get one of them out of the water, then that's the goal. So you're trying to get that heel out of the boat, but you want as little heel as possible that just removes the hull from the water. And Ben Saxton and Nicola Boniface here just doing a pretty fantastic example of that, where the boat almost looks flat, but they've just got that windward hull out of the water to just reduce the drag. So maximise righting moment, but minimise drag. That's the goal with all of it really here. But a nice smooth job, clear air. And again, they were
They moved ahead of Argentina by the look of it, or maybe you think they were second.
I thought they were
anyway.
Second at the windward mark, and I'd have been surprised on a downwind leg like that was so long on starboard tack if they'd have lost really a guy of Ben's calibre. But you can see Ruggiero here, great pressure. Again, they've got the boat locked in pretty nicely as well. Any of the catamaran coaches out there, I'm sure, will be studying this pretty hard to try and work out why are they so quick. And that's camera angle. That's not all. That's not how much faster they are. But also, I think they're up on the left, and they look like they've got a bit of better breeze. And Ben Saxton was in the background tacking just at that point. So, you know, this left-hand side is pretty strong, and these guys, they sail the boat beautifully.
Well, while they go upwind and continue with their lead, we can just briefly update on the 49er men's fleet outside racing on the one of the outer courses. We've seen now two races for the 49er men's, and we were talking about how up and down it is inside for the Nacras. It looks a bit more stable outside. We've got Pete and Blair have a 6 and a 4, and that's jumped them back into the lead. The Spanish team with an 8 and 12 dropping into second, only three points back from first place. Dylan Fletcher and Stuart Bithell with a 4 and a 7, so also two top 10s to stay in third. After the first race, they'd moved up to third. And then Eustace and Max Boehm, the Germans, with a 23, so scoring their discard in the last race and dropping to fourth in the day. Logan Dunningback, Oscar Gunn, 11 and a 2, moves them into fifth. And the younger Brits, the James and Finn, 2 and a 14. But then I think really good scores here, a 5 and a 1 for Eric Heil and Thomas Plossel, and we saw them struggle yesterday with the capsize in second place, so we could almost expect them to be doing much better in the racing if they hadn't had that, and then a 3 and a 5 from the Phillips brothers. So it looks like out there on the 49er fleet, it's probably a bit easier conditions. These scores are not nearly as mixed up as the NACRA scores. These are more the guys in the top 10 gaining and having top 10s every race, so I think what we're seeing in here, much trickier.
Absolutely, and we saw their Tito and Banti absolutely smack on the poor lay line. So they've really limited any overtaking lanes for anyone else by getting right to that poor lay line. And I mean, this is a little bit of a worrying show of strength for the rest of the fleet, I'd say right now, because they are gone.
And in these conditions, the ones we've been saying are so difficult to be consistent in, and to be winning two races on the trot is phenomenal.
Yeah, I mean, they've got they've clearly figured out what to do. Should have come out a word with us before the first race, maybe, but good job for the interest of the regatta, they didn't. But they're boosting away here.
Yeah, clearly it's almost half a leg looking at that distance there. That's incredible lead to GBR 91, so well done to the Italians.
And, you know, they've made it. Ben and Nicky have, you know, they were obviously playing the shifts up the beat, but they've had to do an extra couple of tacks. That was free distance. But you can see there's a real battle now, third, fourth, fifth, sixth. It's going to be a really, really tight race to finish. Is that Senholt and Lubeck coming around there?
So it's Norrigard. I think it's Norrigard and
Iversen. Oh, it's Norrigard, is it? Okay, yeah. So that's a good race there. GBR 21. So that's Gimpson having a good result as well. So there's a few Brits up there, but that's much, much better from John Gimpson. This could be a really good result for them to get things going well again. But the points are flying around a bit today, and Ruggiero's done a great job. I think, interestingly, I've not noticed the outrages go around yet, and I probably, after their windward mark, would have expected or hoped that they might have been able to chip away on a few shifts, but that just shows that here they come now. So they've had a solid race here, but not perhaps the overtaking opportunities that they might have liked. You can just see the course has turned into a bit of a pattern of going straight down this side and coming back out there on the upwind. So,
and interestingly, that was just the Danes rounding there. That was the Norwegians, and then behind them, the Danes, who had been leading this regatta going into this race. So they were on 28 with Ruggiero and Caterina on 30. I think this will shuffle the leaderboard once again. We'll have the Italians back up to the top of the leaderboard after this race. We'll have to see whether Lynn and CP end up dropping this score or dropping the 14th that they had in the last race, but either of these, not amazing scores for the day. And as you said, John and Anna needed to turn it around, and it seems like they've done so. So they'll be able to probably solidify at least the third position, the bronze, with this fourth place at the moment. Is that that? No, GBR 25 is a different team.
I think they were just ahead of GB. I think they're ahead of GBR 25. I think their tracker's gone. At the moment, but yeah, I mean, it'd just be a great result because tough day and to get a good solid low score. You know, there's a lot more racing to happen tomorrow, and you know, Ben Saxton here in shot, Nicola Boniface got the boat going very smoothly. Clearly enjoys the shifty conditions. Ben sails a lot of classes in the UK, Andy, so he seems to always be racing something.
Yeah, and he attributes his ability in the NACRA or in any boat that he sails to the breadth of boats that he does race in. He thinks that everything that he sails in, no matter how irrelevant it may seem to the peculiarities of NACRA racing, is all relevant sailing experience. So not a specialist. And you do see specialists do well, but I really think there's a lot to be said for
him. He's certainly a specialist today.
Ruggero
Toti, around the leeward mark already. No one else in shot, or no one else he's racing in shot.
These are the silver fleet, is what Steve is referring to. The boats behind him who are sitting are not racing.
Yes, and you know, so here he goes, he's well away. And that was Saxton and Boniface in the background, just about to go around the mark. But he's fully in charge of his own destiny here. Clearly very happy with the left side of the course, and would be pretty surprised if we don't just see him come all the way out to the ley line again and you know, put himself on keeping it simple. Basically, he's pretty happy with his idea of the course. It's going to be a small loss. He's going under the fleet there. There's dirty wind, but he's clearly happy that sacrifice is more than made up for by the gain to be found on the port ley line.
And I was just going to say the breeze is looking more solid, but now they do actually have to crouch in for a moment. But generally, the breeze does seem to be a bit more reliable than it was, say, 20 minutes ago. But now they're still crouched. They're not back up to full power yet.
No, and they're just going, that's just debris of the, you know, disturbed wind from the fleet coming downwind. So he's going to know he's making a bit of a sacrifice there, but he's hoping that once he gets clear, and there you go, he's out, clear from the bulk of the fleet, and then he's seen that left-hand side's tended to prove good. I mean, the fact you can see no one in the background there still suggests that probably Saxton's come round and is following.
Making life easy for the Italians if they are.
But if it's the right thing to do, it's the right thing to do. And, you know, there might not be an opportunity for Ben Saxton here. Second place is a great finish. And to try and pull off one magic trick by heading to the right to get to first would just be crazy. So sometimes the right thing to do is to follow.
Sometimes your next tactical decision is tomorrow.
Some great guy said that, didn't he? I heard some guys say that before.
So your next tactical decision is what's dinner?
Yeah, how exactly. Maybe that's. But will the Italians be choosing the pasta after they get ashore?
I think we've actually had this literal conversation here, and I'm not sure
it's Groundhog Day.
British pasta is what the Italians are looking for ever in their lives, much less, you know. But anyway, I won't assume to know what they think of the pasta here, per se.
I did ask them, and you don't want to know.
Fair enough. But you can see in the background of the picture there, Ben Saxton. So he has gone left at the bottom mark and got himself a little bit of leverage. So he's got an attacking opportunity. Clearly felt he was far enough ahead of third that it was worth taking a small punt out towards the right a little bit, splitting at the bottom mark. So he's not really gone right. He's just split at the bottom mark and got some separation. And he won't have sailed under the boats coming downwind like Tito and Banti have had to. So potentially a gain here, but my guess is the left's still pretty strong. But Saxton and Boniface have just given himself a little chance to have an attack without taking too much risk.
And this is really opened out, hasn't it? I mean, this is perhaps the widest open race we've seen all day, with the gaps really, really stretching.
Yeah, I mean, I think it's obviously got a bit more puffy, bit more gusty, so the boats can get properly up to speed. And when that speed difference is so much more, then you start to jump the gaps out. It's interesting looking at that. this beat, the fleet is looking more open. Australia 46 has got himself a bit right of the course. Denmark 336 as well. There's a few people coming a little bit more out to the right hand side, and hopefully that's a calculated risk rather than a lucky punt, but we'll find out in the end. But you can see there Saxton and Boniface keeping themselves quite near the middle of the racetrack. They're slightly left of middle, but they're not, you know, they're trying to eliminate risk, and in shifty weather you eliminate the risk by being not too far from the middle of the course when you can.
Well, it's fun to see Denmark 336. That's Katja Iversen, who is a bronze medalist from the 49er FX, who was training in the 49er FX with her skipper Jana Hansen until last year, when Jana decided essentially to retire, and she's now gone into coaching the Danish team here. And so Katja moved into the NACAR kind of late in this squad, so to see them late in this squad, to see them doing well. But it also lets us take a moment there to just take a look at the 49er FX fleet itself. We have updated now the two races from outside on their race course, and it looks like an amazing day so far for Alex Maloney and Molly Meets. They've scored a 3 and a 1, and that's moved them from third or even fourth this morning up into second place overall. Martin Grail and Kayana Kuntz still leading with a 5 and a 12, dropping their 12. I think that's the first time they've been out of the top 10 in a long time, definitely in this regatta. But they're still leading overall by 19 points. So well done to the Brazilians for having such a solid one. And then just 1 point back from second is the Dutch team of Annemiek and Annette, 46 points. Then another 9 points to Charlotte Dobson and Saskia Tidy, who haven't had an amazing day today with a 10 and a 23. And then Helen Nass and Marie Ronigan, the Norwegians we were speaking about earlier, they said they needed to get off the start line yesterday. It looks like they've done so. 2/4 is the second best score line of the day. So good job with those girls. And again, good job to the young Swedish team, Vilma and Malin, for scoring in with a 6th place here. And another great storyline down in 11th with a 1 and 6 to the American team. So Paris and Anna following up their win in the first race with the 6th place there. But we can go back to the Knackers, but that's just, if you guys are looking for it online, those are just the scores for the 49er and the FX, and you can find them again on the 2019 Volvo European Championship, just clicking through the results there.
So bang on the ley line again, Andy. Clearly we know what he likes to do on this course. He's pretty happy coming out to the left, and again, he's got a big enough lead. He just wants to keep things simple, try and minimise manoeuvres, minimise opportunity for people to get leverage, and just, you know, sail the boat smoothly. He's clearly very, very quick. When they get their head out front, they know how to run away, and they know how to be a very good front runner. So, so far, touch wood, we'll see that they get down this last leg, but I'll be pretty surprised if they didn't manage to execute this last downwind leg and stay ahead, because that's Ben Saxton and Nicky Boniface just coming round the mark now. So great result for Ben and Nicky, but they are well and truly behind the leading boat there of Ruggiero and Caterina, who have given a bit of a masterclass in the last two races, I think it's fair to say.
Yeah, and very hard to tell from our perspective as to what the differences are. I mean, obviously, we know on this in these kind of boats, on this kind of course where it's tending to pay to one side, that the rich do tend to get richer. But why is it the Italian boat twice in a row? It is impressive. And I think it shows that the Italians are great sailors. It's not just about having inherently good boat speed. I think sometimes people think that their technical program is really good, but clearly technique wise and in terms of pure tactical sailing ability, they're one of the best as well.
Yeah, their racecraft in these last two races has been great, and you know, that's absolutely their starting. You can't just have done it today on boat speed, for sure. He sailed a fantastic day, and what's really nice to see as well, just coming around there in fourth place with the blue Jenica, is the yellow jersey. So that's John Gibson and Anna Burnett. Not been an easy day, but fourth, I think hugely, hugely impressive, because they got to the winner mark in a decent place in this race, not a great place, and he's been patient enough to chip away when I imagine inside the two of them have probably been screaming as to, you know, what's been happening today, and perhaps trying to force it. So I think looking ahead to tomorrow, this is a hugely impressive result for John and Anna, and really, really nice to see. Granted, not quite as impressive as the Italian team, who have been awesome, but fantastic to see in such a tight race. You see all the boats going around the mark now, but
Good for their mental fortitude, isn't it? Yeah, if they'd had a third shocker today, then that would have been quite difficult to deal with mentally this evening as they were getting their British pasta at the end of the day.
Yeah. There's several mental hits to be taken then by the sound of it on that one. But
we've got another British team rounding now, but we spoke a lot yesterday about what this event means for the different countries and the different teams. How does it work for the British qualification for the test event and the Tokyo 2020 games, and what is riding on this for both John and Anna and Ben and Nicola and the other British teams here?
I think the reality is, unless you're in the room and have signed the contract with the British staging team, you don't know exactly what the selection process is or isn't, but it has to be, as the Italians cross the finish line here, bang, so that's two wins in a while. Now, we know they're a long way ahead, so perhaps can go back to talking about that issue, but we don't know, I suppose, is the thing. I guess if I was in charge of the selection, then an event in home waters like this, that's a massive Europeans, it must be important for selection to the pre-Olympics. It has to be.
But even just saying that is an interesting, to Americans, it's such a clear, transparent, here's how the selection process works. And to be able to say the British is not clear and it's not transparent and it's behind closed doors and the selection committee makes their decisions.
It'd be very transparent to the sailors. It's just not, I don't know, because I'm not in that room.
Right.
I used to be in that room. And I had a contract that said you can't tell anyone what the selection process for the Olympic Games I went to was, but that was a long time ago, so things have changed, and this has to be important. You see Ben Saxton and Nicola Boniface crossing in second, really strong day for them. They've been on the back foot a bit from a British perspective, I suppose, over this regatta because of John and Anna, and you can't help but think this event's very, very important in terms of getting selected to go to Japan this summer for the test event. But equally, we've got 49er FX, NACRA World Championships over the winter, I think they're in Auckland at the end of the year. And, I'd be surprised if many people are getting selected for the Olympic Games before those big regattas, but that's
The Dutch are the ones that spring to mind.
Gimson, so is that third?
And they moved into fourth here. I think that was Nicola and Ben in third, correct? Although, let me pull up the tracker.
They moved into second
and third. So well done to both the British
great
teams.
Great result for John and Anna there on the comeback. And nice, really, really good for everyone there. Alan Norgaard, he was a 49er sailor when I was sailing the 49er, bronze medalist. So a good result for him.
And then the Argentinians just crossing there into fifth. And then a very tight battle here for the second.
And that'll be right. Rupert White and Kirsty Owen just capsizing their just agonizing moments before the finish.
Hopefully,
about to cross
the
in
line,
seventh place, and it's unclear as to where the pin into the line is at the moment, and it's unclear as to what went wrong there. I mean, it's so light.
Gone blue on the tracker.
They may well have, so
maybe they were going for the finish of the regatta award. I don't know, but certainly when they get home tonight and watch a replay of this, they can be very proud of their dismount there, because that was a spectacular way to try and sign off, and might even find themselves on the front of some yachting press tomorrow morning, Andy, I'd imagine, eh?
Well, you get on the front page any way you can, don't you?
Yeah, exactly, yeah.
I don't know if I'd want to take that way. I think there's other ways of avoiding being on the front page with that one. But if they crossed the line in seventh and didn't lose a single boat, then you might as well take it in that place. But I missed what went wrong in their drive. I mean, I think realistically we saw these tiny puffs come down that mean that teams are fully trapping at times. And that might have just been that it hit just at the wrong time when they were trying to go through the drive to try to bear away to cross the finish line. And that is an embarrassing moment for them, but nonetheless, it didn't actually hurt so badly on the score line, so it's not too much tongue-in-cheek embarrassment there, but...
No, and maybe, who knows, maybe that was the dive for the finish, the dip chest finish on the 100-meter sprint. Didn't see, but
the lengths people will go to for that last 1 or 2 seconds is incredible, isn't it?
It does seem to be, yeah. But
Outridge is still to finish. They're just about crossing, I think.
Yeah, they've just crossed there. So at points in that race, they were fourth or even fifth, and they've finished now in 14th. So I think it was perhaps the second downwind and third upwind that didn't quite go their way. And
found themselves on the right, didn't
exactly.
They?
Yeah. We'd seen them gain on the right before, and I think realistically, the left was so much better that race that they might have just not been able to perform from the right-hand side. The Austrians as well, quite deep, just crossing the line there at the committee boat into the line. So we've talked a lot about them and the bronze medalists, and we had an onboard camera with them earlier. But they also drop back through the race, throughout that race.
Billy Besson and Marie Rieu just going out of picture to the left. We used to talk about them a lot in the previous Olympic cycle going into Rio 2016, winner of all four world titles going into Rio. And they're just another boat here, aren't they? We're not finding many reasons to talk about the French at this regatta.
No, I think it's been probably, it's a bit of a change since it's gone fully foiling and they've had other projects. Marie, of course, was part of the Dongfeng Volvo Ocean Race winning team. So she's been off achieving some pretty amazing feats away from the Olympic scene. I think that it's very much their first season back, I guess, fully up and running. But what they're going to be seeing is that they've got a lot of work to do.
Well, they've had a tough day today with the 20 and 11, but they also have a tough scoreline. They've got three DPIs in their scoreline, Andy.
So that was for not having a knife on board. For safety reasons, you're required to have a knife on board. The measurer spotted that they didn't have a knife on board for day two of competition, and they paid a heavy price for that. They were given a points penalty for not having the knife on board, which I know they weren't happy about, but rules is rules.
Rules is rules. Do we know how many points that points penalty is?
I'm not sure how
it's... Look at the math. And
I'm not sure if that calculation is still running based on all their scores, because I think that's a jury decision as to whether it's applied just to the races that day. So I'm sorry, I don't know the detail, but I do know the reason.
Yeah, that's an unfortunate accidental penalty to have that happen. That's a mistake you would expect them not to be making at that level, but
you would think.
Nonetheless, it does happen. I think Ben's guessing it's probably something like 5% per race, which would be about a point per race for 5% of the fleet per race. But sitting on 107 points, you know, last year they were always constantly fighting. Last quad, they were constantly fighting in the medals. Today they'd come into the racing 13th, and I think they've dropped throughout the day on a bad day to sitting even deeper than that. So,
well, Teter and Banti are the new Besson and Rieu of this quad, really,
exactly,
aren't they?
Exactly, and today they showed why, right? I mean, two bullets on a day like today when we were saying the scores are going to be so up and down and we should expect it. They might have had, they had a rough first one with a 13th, but to follow that up just with two, really nailing the bullets as well, and I think they just figured out the race course better than anyone else.
They certainly seem to. I mean, you know, they were able to execute. I mean, as we say, there's a lot of chat about how fast they are or not, but you won't get as we saw, when they weren't in a position of space, then is irrelevant. You've got to be able to put yourself in that space and be able to make those skills and techniques that you've learned actually start to work for you. And they did a fantastic job. And you know, we did see in the first race it was perhaps a little harder. There was a hint of Port M bias on the start line. People were a bit unsure. There was a 50-50 split on the fleet. You could see there wasn't a huge amount of confidence in what was the right strategy. And as the day's gone on, then if you know, put a paint line on the course where most of the guys were going, it was quite clearly coming out to this one side, and that's where you've got to evolve through the day. And we saw it yesterday in the 49er FX that the good guys were a bit all over the place in the first race of the day, and then the next race, bang, this is what the race course looks like, this is what we've got to do. And that's what this level of sailing is.
But doesn't that mean that the level could go higher? Shouldn't they be doing more homework before race one rather than using race one to do their homework?
Probably. Yeah, you sound like my dad. That's what my dad always used to say to me. Yeah. You've got to get out there early. I mean, there's only so long you want to spend in a wetsuit. But yeah, I mean, there is more to do, and that's why we go to the Olympic venue and we spend weeks and months and years training on that water. And, you know, it's not easy for me to say, but I've spent 10, 12 years sailing in Weymouth, probably 3 months a year. So when it comes round this wind direction, I kind of know what's going to happen. And those guys, yeah, you could go out a little bit early, but there's a danger you can get a misread on things. You've got to do so much that you get a huge read. But yes, well, I think we could probably tell them to get off the beach.
Looking at the number of Union Jacks at the pin end of the line in the last start, it looks like there was a team message that went out.
It wasn't me.
Left hand. Maybe they're listening.
Well, I think they've
there.
Been watching our feed. They've been watching the TV out there.
And realistically, I think towards the Olympic classes and big events as well, you might do that with the training group, that you go out and you do, all right, here's our course is set. Let's do our splits. I'm left, you're middle, you're right. But you have to make sure that everyone is exactly the same speed to then go, okay, I've gone left, you've gone middle, you've gone right, and the person on the right won because they crossed five boat lengths ahead. And in the NACRA, that one tiny puff, or that one kind of, if you put Ruggiero against the other Italians, they're not necessarily going to ever be able to say that the splits make it so obvious that the left side is the winning side or the right side is the winning side on something like a Yuengling or a Finn or a Laser, when the boats aren't so drastically different in speed with each puff, then and maybe it's a bit easier to just do splits and go, boom, that's the left. And some of it might be, how much is that extra hour of sleep worth that extra 30 minutes of getting out on the race course? And if you can mentally make better decisions because you've either fueled up longer or debriefed harder or pre-briefed better or something like that, or you've spent that 30 minutes testing, every team probably weighs it up differently. And strong teams like the Brits, I would expect that there should be some sort of, and there probably are splits out there prior to the race, and you can then take that into race one. But yesterday we saw race one was not necessarily at all the same as race two, which was not necessarily at all the same as race three. And the guys who had been watching the FX's race then had a totally different race course themselves. Today was interesting that the pattern emerged, and we can call it, and this was the pattern. And that does happen a lot, but yesterday it didn't happen at all. So you might have just been wasting 40 minutes of going, here's how the women's racing work. That's the thing that's going to be the trick. And it, you know, race one for the men was a totally different, I said diamond to crack or something, but it was a totally different thing, even though it was the exact same marks, the exact same breeze conditions and strengths. Yeah. And
further out to sea, here today, I think there was more of an effect off the land, wasn't there? There was, we didn't really see the land that was causing it from our camera angles, but just over our shoulder when we were at the top mark, though the land up there seemed to be creating some constant effect that made the left, particularly at the top of the course, really powerful.
Yeah, I think so, and I just think traditionally you see that in the bay here, but I think in answer to your question with the going out early and understanding the course, I mean, I think probably the mistake the Italians made in that first race was, all right, if we don't know exactly what's going on, what's my strategy that I approach the race to limit risk, that I can maybe get to the Wimmer Mark 10th? Okay, I'm not trying to desperately win the race because I don't know exactly what's happening with the wind. Well, the Italian and the Greek girl came firing off the start line on Port Tack, and they were committed very extremely to the right-hand side of the course in the same way as Chris Rashley was right off the pin end of the line, and he was quite aggressive in his strategy. If you're not sure of your strategy, let's make sure we're somewhere nearer the middle of the course and we keep, it's boring, very boring, but often it is boring to do well, is keep your options open. If you know, Rashley was right, could have easily been wrong. The Greek and Ruggiero were wrong, could have been right. But if you don't know, trying to put yourself that little bit in a controlling position on starboard to windward, or if you start on port, start a bit later. We saw Nathan Outeridge started a little bit later on Port Tack in that one. So he's in a position where it's a bit hard to do on the camera, it's easy showing you, but he's on the inside, you're on the inside. Okay, so maybe that side's going to win, but I'm quite close to that side. Maybe that side's going to win, but I'm not too far. I'm kind of in the middle of the pack, and I'm not going to have a disastrous race, and I'll learn the course from it. And actually, because I've got good speed, I've got better tacks, better jibes, better handling, maybe I actually get a sixth or a seventh or an eighth out of a race that I didn't really have a clue what was happening. And so I think it's interesting how they approached it, and can often be a hard thing about when you're used to winning all the time. You know, you think, I should be able to win this, I should know what's going on, I'm going to take this on, I'm going to bang, I'm punchy, I've got this. And you know, when he did know what was going on, wow.
Yeah.
Awesome.
I think realistically, if we look at the scores, Ben Saxton and Nicola Bonifacio, they came out of that into second. You know, they did have the cojones to go, we're going to tack across the fleet and we're going to nail it and it's going to be great. And unfortunately for Chris Rashley, they dropped 2/10 in that race. These are the scores overall, but that race again was won by the Italians, followed by the two British teams, Ben Saxton and Nicola, and then John Gimson and Anna Burnett. And that's how this has switched up the scores overall. So the Italians finally moving back to the top of the leaderboard. You can see after the first five races, they were very much at the top of the leaderboard, but they had dropped for the past day because of the team of Lennon, CP Lubeck there. And now it's a 5-point gap again for them into first place. And then back into third, John Gimson and Anna Burnett. And that third place, it just would have been a good mental task for them, a good mental regroup ability and pull it off. And I think that allows them to feel confident going into the rest of the week. Argentina in fourth, a solid day today for 8-5 might be the best day. No, mathematically it's not. But yeah, it's a decent day as well for them and for Ben and Nicola sitting in fifth. And Andy, what do you think looking at these score lines? It just shows how tricky the day has been.
Yeah, and we haven't spoken much about the Argentinians today, but they've sort of been there and thereabouts. And sometimes, Steve, you always like boring, don't you? You just mentioned boring. Boring is good, isn't it?
I can be really boring to you now, Ricey. So we talked about the fact that we thought yesterday in the FX racing, three top fives would be a great day. So the best results today is Ruggero Tito with a 13-1-1, 15 points. Now, your mathematics tells us what's that average?
What, of 15 points divided by 3 is 5.
Right, and Ben Saxton, 8 plus 2 plus 5, 15. So there you go. The two best days today on three races was an average of 5th.
So now the three best days, really, Stevie, if you're going to do all the math, look at the top one. 13-1-1 is also 15.
Yeah, but I don't think 5-8-4. Anyway, let's not get there, Anna. I'd already...
So what would you rather have, 13-1-1 or 8-5-2?
13-1-1, as long as I can continue to discard the 13.
Right.
Kind of irrelevant. We don't know that until the end of tomorrow. I'd be happy to leave the day with either of those. But yes, ultimately, the 13-1-1's a bit better. But I wonder what risk he's taking. My point is, if you can get out of a day like today, averaging top fives in this golf fleet, in this high level, it's the best day. And if you approach a race thinking, I want to finish 5th, your strategy is a lot easier to achieve than trying to think, I've got to win the race. You know, you can be that bit more safe and that bit more conservative with your decision making. And I just always find at this high level of racing, how often that's the... You know, how often it's so hard to achieve something that on paper doesn't sound that spectacular.
Yeah, well, I think coming back to what you were saying about don't bounce out towards the corners too early if you don't know which side is going to pay. I think that's all well and good when you've got race-winning speed. But when you are a Chris Rashley or when you're the Germans that did the port tax start, you've got to take those kind of risks, I feel. To have a chance.
But he's in a different competition.
Yes.
I completely agree. Yeah, I completely agree. But we're talking about someone trying to win the event.
Yeah.
Chris Rashley's a super talented sailor. So Jonas, you know, Johannes, amazingly talented guy, but hasn't quite cracked the NACRA, magic just yet. So therefore, yes, to get the race win, if they're 10th, they're probably going to stay 10th or even drop a bit, or it's a bit 50-50. You'd hope that someone like Ruggero, someone like Ben Saxton, John Gimpson, all these guys at the top of the fleet, the Argentinians, I think, were the classic example today. Probably got to the windward mark just in the top 10 in every race, overtook one boat on every leg, and that ends up with a day that looks like that. Third best day, awesome.
Yeah?
Yeah? Really good. And they probably not, we'd say, we haven't seen them. The fact we haven't seen them means they've been very unspectacular. Yeah, they've walked away with the third best day. And, it's very, like I say, it's very, very easy to sit here in the studio and do it and say what they should do. And it's very, very hard to actually execute that out on the water. But
The outrages surprised me a little bit, because flat water, that should have put them back in the mix again today. They didn't have the excuse of, you know, lack of experience in the waves. We saw them burst onto the scene last season in contention for winning the Worlds last year in Aarhus. I mean, just spectacularly fast progress last year. So I'm sort of a little bit surprised that they didn't make more of an impact today.
Yeah, I think that's it. That's it. We can ask them. I'm sure Nathan's so good at being so open and honest about where his strengths and weaknesses lie. And I think realistically, they would happily say, I'm sure probably one of the weaknesses right now is time in the boat and time on the water and time away from the sun.
Got a brand new
time.
Boat, haven't
yeah.
they?
Yeah, things like that. Yeah,
and a fairly brand new baby as well in Nathan's case.
Yeah, fairly brand new baby. Well, anyway, that is the scores for the NACRAs at the end of the day. As we said, the 49ers and the FXs are still racing out there at the moment. They've both got one more race on Gold Fleet. We don't have those accurate scores yet. So as it looks like, the men's fleet is still Pete Burling and Blair Tuke at the top, Diego Botín and Yago Mara sitting second, Dylan Fletcher and Stuart Bithell in third, but it's still very close all the way down to even 7th and 8th place there. FX women, the same, one more race to go on the score line. So again, keep refreshing if you're following along. But Martin Grail, Kayana Kunz, the Brazilian, still leading, followed by the Kiwis, followed by the Dutch, and closely still British and Norwegians and Swedes after that. And I think soon that will be it from us here for a brief gap. Andy will be back shortly for the Magic Marine intermission show with Ben Remucker. They will be talking us through some more world sailing event stuff. I know there's also racing in the Star Sailors League going on out there today. So if you are a super fan who's trying to maybe avoid some work wherever you are watching us, feel free to go and watch them also.
Is that not what we're doing?
Are we avoiding work?
Doesn't feel like work.
Perhaps. Yeah. And then tomorrow we'll be back again with the 49er men, the Gold Fleet Racing again for all three fleets. We know we'll be covering the men. Hopefully we'll get to cover another fleet if they stagger the races, but we'll let you know overnight what the times will be. The assumption probably at the moment is that it's going to stay for 11, but as we saw for today, they switched to 10 a.m. because the breeze came up earlier. So make sure to be following us on all the social channels. And again, we will be back after short intermission with the Magic Marine Halftime Show.